to order. John will be right along. First item on the agenda is the acceptance of the agenda.
Mr. Chair, I'd like to move to accept the agenda, but modifying it by, because agenda item six, the public hearing, has been continued to May 17th. So agenda item six is no longer on there. And just for scheduling reasons, what's currently agenda item four about the sister city, we could move that down to agenda item six, if we could, Mr. Chair.
I second that, Joe.
It's done. All in favor of that?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Thank you. Walk-in period? Anyone here for the walk-in period? Revals for the Board of Assessors there down the hall, so why don't we skip over that?
Number three, Hawker Peddlers?
The Hawker Peddlers for North Scituate Market, yeah. You can do that. Number three. Are you the?
I'm the Roman table.
Good. Why don't you come up, just come up to the table. Come up to this table, if you would. And we have two motions here, one for the Roman table and one for the, yeah, that's fine, right there. And one for Tracy Shepard. Yeah, one second, Tracy. Briefly, what do you plan to sell down there?
I plan to sell olive oil and balsamic vinegar.
Uh-huh.
That is bottled under my own label with Scituate Harbor.
Right, should be a big hit down there.
And you have the store?
Yes.
In the brick old?
Yes, I do.
Fish market, yeah.
Yep.
Great, I was there.
Yeah.
Great tasting.
Yep.
Any questions from the board?
Just a comment. Good luck.
Thank you very
Absolutely.
Much.
Absolutely.
Thank you.
Motion.
Move the Board of Selectmen vote to grant a Hawker Peddlers license to Cynthia Casey, doing business as the Roman Table, to sell olive oils and balsamic vinegars at the North Scituate town-owned commuter rail parking lot in front of the WPA building from 3 p.m. to 7 p.m. on Wednesdays from May 1st to October 31st. This license has a temporary waiver of the 15-minute rule, Selectmen's Policy Number 43-99.
Second.
Discussion? Number four, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Congratulations. Tracy? Again, just a brief summary of what you plan to do. Just.
I will be selling cloth diapers and conducting workshops.
Okay. And workshops right there at the?
Right at the booth. Yes.
Discussion for the board?
Do you gotta clean them?
Only my own. My daughter's, technically not mine.
Do you have a business that does this?
I do. I have a web-based business currently operating out of my home. And, you know, one of the major obstacles to people purchasing cloth diapers is they don't know what they are and how to use them. So I'm looking for a home to conduct workshops and meet more families who are looking for sustainable products.
That's that's interesting. That
it is interesting.
That there is a whole generation that doesn't know how to use cloth diapers.
Yeah. Very true.
I don't know what that says about me, but I think I know. Sean?
Is it true, and I don't mean to put you on the spot,
sure,
that the disposable diapers represent 2% of the landfills?
Disposable diapers, that's in the range, estimates
wow.
1 to 3.
Wow.
Yep, it's the, from any home that has a diaper child, it's the largest trash item. Anywhere between 6,000 diapers, I think an average child goes through. Take 250 to 500 years to decompose. Major health hazard is that most parents don't realize they should dispose of solid waste before
right.
putting diapers in the garbage.
So. 6,000 is about right.
Yeah.
I calculated it out. I had four kids, just went through the whole diaper phase, and we were at 22,000 for the four.
You so have to find right. something to do with your time, Mr.
Yeah, it just it goes to
that.
Show what my kids are full of.
Further discussion for the board? If not, a motion.
Move that the Board of Selectmen vote to grant a Hawker Peddlers license to Tracy Shepard to sell cloth baby diapers at the North Scituate town-owned commuter rail parking lot in front of the WPA building from 3 p.m. to 7 p.m. on Wednesdays from May 1st to October 31st. This license has a temporary waiver of the 15-minute rule, which is
second.
Sorry.
That's
all right.
Motion's been made as seconded. Discussion from the board? Discussion from the floor? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? It's unanimous.
Good luck.
Thank you. Good luck. And our esteemed assessors are here, and assessor, would you back him up with, once we do, take you right now.
Thank you, Mr. Acting Chairman.
Mr. Sullivan, how are you?
I'm well, yourself.
Steve, how are you?
Good, thank you. How are you?
Good. Once again, I think we know that this is a, every 3 years?
Yep.
Maybe you can give us a brief explanation of what it is.
Thank you, Mr. Acting Chairman. On behalf of the Board of Assessors, I'm Brian Sullivan, and with me is Steve Jarzembowski, the assessor. And as you know, every 3 years, the town is required to do a revaluation, and accordingly, the assessors put out through an RFP a proposal for the revaluation contract, and upon review of the bid received, the Board of Assessors voted and unanimously recommended that the contract be awarded to Paul S. Capinos and Associates. For the contract be awarded to Paul S. Capinos and Associates to do the revaluation for fiscal year 2012. And as you look through your material, you see he's done work with the town before. He has submitted his schedule of work that he proposes to do, and of course the work that would be done by the assessing department. And there's a list of towns throughout the state, some 30 some odd towns that Capinos does work with, and I'm sure you recognize the names of a lot of those towns. He's well known and has a great reputation in the business.
Good evening, Mr. Sullivan.
Good evening, Mr. Chairman.
Steve, how are you? My biggest question is, why is the valuation for valuing commercial property higher than residential valuation on this, given the fact that we
have a smaller base?
Smaller base.
It is much more detail. With the commercial parcel properties, we have to run an income approach to value and a cost approach. The analysis is much more detailed on commercial. We get a number of returns back from commercial property owners, income and expense. it's just, there's a lot of analysis that goes into the commercial sector, even though the parcel count, as you said, is 5% versus 95% of residential.
Yeah, that was my only thought on this, was that it seems very reasonable in light of it, but pretty disproportionate in light
of the review and the
valuation.
Collection of those properties in the field is much more labor intensive. When you're out there and you're looking at a five or ten tenant building that may be 20,000 square feet or 10,000 square feet, the time and effort to do that takes is a longer time than a single family home. So,
questions from the board?
If I can add on that, so is that commercial meaning rental properties? Does that fall into that?
Basically, Front Street, Greenbush.
No, I'm not commercial, but say someone owns an apartment building or somebody owns a duplex or something.
An apartment building is run on an income approach as well.
It is.
It's looked at how many units are there, what the rental income is, what the expenses are. The same method as a commercial property, whether it be a retail or office space.
Okay. So not only is it a retail establishment, it's
can be a multi yes, a 4-unit building, a 10-unit building, Kent Village, 64 units.
Right.
Almost.
But that doesn't capture like people who cottage here and then rent it out for the remainder of the year.
Mr. Murray.
Just a question I'd ask this of any sort of contract that we're interested in giving. Why only one bid? One response, right? Yeah.
Well, what generally happens is in the mass appraisal world in Massachusetts, there were three or four big vendors.
Yeah.
This being one of them, there's a Patriot Properties and a Vision as well. Yeah.
That's why they sort of divide it all up.
No, what they do is unless somebody has not been satisfied with the product and they've had difficulty with that vendor, they more times than not, it's hands off.
Yeah.
That's just the way it works.
Sure.
Because what happens is that we've used their software, and we've used their software since 2005, and actually it goes back before that. So if a new vendor comes in or a new company bids, sometimes there's difficulty with the software,
mm-hmm.
with using that particular product. So over the years we have had multiple bids, but the last two or three times there's only been one bid.
Yeah. All right, cool. Thanks. I'd like to learn the industry. Thank you.
And you're okay with that, Steve?
Yes. Yeah.
Just one last question. I'm sorry. Go ahead, John.
You familiar with these people, Tricia?
Yes.
South Hadley.
Yes, and I asked Steve the same question, but
It's also like an auditor. When an auditor comes in,
right,
there's a lot of stuff to learn, and then you actually get a benefit when they return in subsequent years.
They have an upper hand.
Because they're more efficient and stuff like that. But what Steve says is true. There's only three or four firms that do it in the state, and they don't bid. This went through the 30B procurement. It was advertised. But also, you know, in my view, Mr. Capinos has served the town very well in terms of the revaluation, so there's no concerns there.
The example is his commercial appraiser, the individual doing the commercial side of the equation, has been working with us here since 1991. He's done every reval on the commercial side for 20 years. He has an extensive knowledge, and he has he's the guy that we're very comfortable with in our commercial work.
Good. Another example is when Steve and I were at the auction when the Clipper ship was sold, and he nailed the value to within $100,000 of that auction price, which I thought was pretty good.
Just two quick questions. This contract to the independent contractor agreement, is this our contract?
Yes.
It is. Good.
It's usually on stationary.
And you just talked about the economies of scale that they get when they do more, but the price always seems to be the same.
It's actually, well, it's about been the same the last two or three revals. Yeah. But historically, back in 91 or 88, we spent $125,000 for a reval. The price has come down, actually, in the last
So it's just the last two
years.
Or three that have been?
As technology and computer, the whole thing, it's got to the point where the job can be streamlined. Before, it was much more. We still do the entry, but a lot of the work now is it's gotten better. And DOR has improved the way we have to do things, so it has gotten better. So consequently, the price has maintained about the same. But it's about $8 a parcel, give or take.
Thanks.
Motion?
Move the Board of Selectmen vote to award the contract for the fiscal year 2012 revaluation to Paul S. Capinos and Associates, South Hadley, Mass., for the total bid price of $72,000. This includes field review, residential valuation, commercial valuation, and DOR certification.
Second.
Seconded by Mr. Harris. Further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
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 Unanimous. Gentlemen, thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you
very much.
Thanks.
Gentlemen, and Kim and Tricia, and ladies and gentlemen, I apologize for being late. I was watching my son and daughter at different fields at Gates and Cudworth playing baseball, and I needed to see the last inning my son was pitching, so I apologize for my tardiness. And unfortunately, these are the sacrifices we make, being selectmen and people who dedicate themselves to the town and do different committee and board work. So I will not, I'll make sure that doesn't happen again, but again, my apologies. Moving on to the next agenda item, six is now being, I think you probably mentioned that early on, so we're going to go move on to agenda item number seven, which is meet the applicants for the Economic Development Committee. Do we have them here at this point?
I don't think we have them here yet.
If not, I'll tell you what. Let's skip agenda item number seven. We'll move to agenda item number eight, which is a discussion vote, the Board of Selectmen's policy number 43-99. It's regarding hawker peddler's licenses. And obviously, we're trying to look at the location of these mobile cart vendors in location to the businesses that they may or may not impact. So this was an issue that I thought we'd raise to the board, because we have a lot more hawker peddler licenses. We're going to have some later on tonight. And one of the problems that I've noticed, and I think we all have identified, is that occasionally when we issue these licenses, we're giving them or granting them the ability to sell whatever their wares are in certain locations that may impact businesses directly, given their proximity. And I thought there's been an issue that was raised last year when a hawker peddler wanted to sell items, I think it was hot dogs, in Hummerock. We granted the license to do so without realizing that what we in essence had done was given the ability to this individual to sell within, I think, 100 feet of a store, Sands End Cafe. So I think we want to revisit this issue, because we had told the owner of that store we would do so, and I know that if I'm correct, Kim, correct me if I'm wrong, the individuals sought the hawker peddler's license again this year, and I think it would, before we issue it without discussion, I think we should probably discuss this issue, because it does not only impact Hummerock, it potentially impacts businesses throughout the town. So, am I wrong or?
No, no, I should say that it was renewed in.
It was.
It was renewed for the business beach funds in Hummerock.
For this year?
In December.
Okay. So we need to kind of, I think we need to, and I guess I'll defer to everybody else here, but I think we need to address this issue because it's not fair to have direct competition with items for store owners with hawker peddlers. Because we've got to make sure that we don't erode our business base. I mean, obviously, we're going to be talking about economic development, but I think we need to kind of have a policy. We do have a policy. From my review of the policy, it doesn't address this issue. We talk about, within the policy, that it affects ice cream vendors who sell, you know, in their ice cream carts, that they can't sell within certain amount of feet.
Quarter mile.
Quarter mile. And my thought was to raise it to the board to see what your decision is, what your thoughts are. But I personally think that we need to address it to say, you know, either on a case-by-case analysis or if we want to put something in a policy that we need to say, you shouldn't be able to have direct competition within so many feet of certain stores to some degree. So I thought I'd raise it with you and see what your discussion is. Mr. Norton?
Yeah, I think the only reason that ice cream vendors are mentioned specifically, I don't believe when this policy was put together that there were any other vendors. We didn't have hot dog vendors at that time. You know, it was strictly the ice cream truck in the summer. So I think that's why ice cream vendors were singled out here. But I think it's correct. We have a much broader base now when it comes to vendors. So I think we can include vendors and all others in whatever policy we, you know, I'm not sure there's any difference between ice cream and hot dogs when it comes to this policy. I think the problem we're going to be faced with, and I think we have to be very careful, is if you were to adhere to this policy right now, the quarter of a mile, you would have probably every vendor in town would be probably in conflict, in violation. And I don't think that's what we want, you know what I mean? So I think we have to be careful on how we craft this. A quarter of a mile is a long way. So that's my only point. And I don't know what the suggestion, individual basis, study it and come up with a policy. I don't know if we can come up with a policy this quick tonight. I don't know. And do fairness to the policy.
It'd certainly be open to if maybe we take a look at this and try to come up with something, fashion something, mm-hmm. you know, the next 30 days or something to kind of look at it. The reason why I was saying is I happened to go down to Hummerock and I saw the vendor and I was like, oh, that's great. Yeah. Not realizing it until I saw some emails saying I could see why they were directly at the entrance where everybody's funneled in through it. And it's kind of like in mind it when you have the same type of scenario. There used to be a store across the street. The store's no longer there, so they're not in competition with any business out there. So it's a little different dynamic, but it's kind of unfair to some degree. I think we have to be conscientious about where we're going to be putting people. But I just thought we could look into it. Mr. Murray?
Yeah, Mr. Chair, I think it's high time we did take a look at this. So I applaud you for putting this on our agenda and leading a discussion on it. Yeah, Joe, I agree with you. The one quarter mile, I mean, the whole bit about ice cream was because that was all it was. And then now we've got a whole bunch of other things which are good, either in the context of the market, the open air market on the North Scituate, or just other people bringing by. It seems every year there's something new coming in on wheels, mm-hmm. basically, right? I don't know if, Joe, I might disagree with you a little bit. I'm not sure one quarter mile is that huge a distance. I mean, for ice cream, I mean, we're pretty much saying, you know, that was for ice cream people down at the beaches is fine, but just don't put a vendor up, you know, right on Front Street where the couple main ice cream people are. But I agree with your overall point that we got to be careful what distance we put on it because we could end up having a just too large a radius. But on the other hand, I think some wording about competition, I don't know how we would word, I mean, you're the attorney, but I don't know how you'd word define competition, you know?
Yeah, I agree with you. I mean, quarter mile's in there. But I can, right now, my own mind, without getting into it.
Yeah.
probably think of 7 or 8 vendors who are in violation.
Oh, I agree.
If they're within a quarter, if you want to use that quarter of a mile.
Yeah, I agree.
You know what I mean? So I don't know what the number is.
I'm with you on that. I don't know how we would actually word it, but I mean, you end up selling products that are also for sale under a, at a store that's got walls, you know, or something like that. I don't know how you'd end up doing it, but I completely endorse the premise of this. I have no idea how to mechanically do it, but.
I look at it and I say that, you know, not trying to thwart any type of free economy or, you know, business to say, you know, if you can make money, that's great, but I just don't want to diminish the business districts to some degree for people to cherry pick seasonally when the season, the summer season, it's a big season for a lot of businesses. They need to be able to make money, and
I agree.
And so we need to mm-hmm. encourage that. So it's a balance, but I just think, you know, I'm happy to look into it with anybody else.
If it's a value-added thing, like, so someone's bringing in something that's not being offered, right. It's value-added, that's fantastic. Yeah. That gives, you know, increased choices, increased options, and all that sort of stuff. That's okay. And maybe there's still going to be some intrinsic competition, because even if it's not offered by the store, maybe someone's got it restricted. Maybe they only have $10 to spend, and they might spend it on that the hawker peddler as opposed to the physical store. But that you can't really regulate. But what I really want to make sure we don't do is the exact same item
right
out-competing the store right there.
Mr. Vignani?
Yeah, I think I agree with the concern. I mean, we really don't want to, you know, not take into effect the capitalism that yeah. our country's based on. You know, you should be able to do what you want to do. But I think, you know, it depends on the product, whether it's, you know, whether it's the primary product of an establishment. You know, for Sands End, you know, I don't know how many hot dogs they actually sold, but if they had sodas with it too, it maybe really dug into their soda business, you know, and they were able to position themselves directly in the path of the, you know, so I don't know that you can do some blanket thing. You know, if people want to go up and sell things on Peggotty, you know, there's an ice cream truck, there can be a lemonade truck, it's not as big of an issue as in this one incident where somebody actually said, I'm going to put a store in front of the entrance to your store and sell it for a quarter cheaper, you know, who knows.
Right.
But I really think you have to look at the product. I don't know that hot dogs was the issue. It may have been the other products that the people were selling, and people on a hot day only having to walk 500 feet instead of 800 feet. So I agree with you. I think we have to be careful in terms of making this blanket policy. But I think on, you know, we talked about this with Kim a while ago with the ice cream trucks, to get an understanding of where people are going and what the competitive impact is. You know, someone was selling garden vegetables out at Sand Hills. Really wasn't a big deal that they went next to the store there, because that's not a primary
right.
product of, right. of competition. But, you know, maybe in the application, there's got to be some sort of, you know, competitor area that you have to write about where's your closest competitor. And, you know, a quarter of a mile, like Joe says, you know, Scituate's only how wide? You know, no one's going to walk a quarter of a mile for something, you know, on a sunny day at the beach. You know, it could only be 200 feet that is really the issue. So, you know, I'm leery in doing some blanket thing without really just saying a case by case and really giving more direction and say, look, you can do it, but you got to be on the other side of the you got to be on the other side of Sand Hills, Sands Ends, instead of, you know, right up next to the beach.
Right. Sean?
I was just going to say I agree with Joe. Back in this policy, I think, was written in 99. It was really geared towards the ice cream trucks. And when we vote like we just did for the hawkers, peddlers in North Scituate, you know, I think every one of them would be in violation. Yeah, we're waiving the 15-minute rule, but we're not waiving the other. I don't.
That's what I was thinking. Right. Yeah.
And we don't want to do that. And who are we to say? Who are we to tell someone they're in competition with the store? You know, so I kind of agree with Tony. I kind of agree with Rick. So I, you know, but we have to
well, let's
take
that
a good look at it.
And, you know, that case by case analysis too. And right. saying, okay, we need to kind of figure that out without directly impacting, as you say.
We want to encourage these people, like, you know, to come out and, do what they want, you know, do what they want to do. At the same time, we don't want to hurt our local businesses.
I think the other thing we have to do is we've got to make sure that, you know, people are notified. You know, I remember people came in after the fact
you know, we had given a Hawker Peddler's license, they were there, and then 2 weeks later, the competing company said, wait a minute, what's going on here? Whereas if there's almost a notification as if you were doing some sort of, you know, property thing, that they would actually have to, a butter's actually come in.
We do the Hawker Peddlers on an ongoing basis, correct? And I only ask this because I was thinking, could we logistically do it in like a month? I don't not suppose you have the answer, but do it in like a month or 2 month period of saying, if you want a Hawker Peddler's license, it has to be done during these 2 months of the year. Or Tricia, I don't know if you've seen that, or I doubt you have from a town perspective. I'm just thinking, because then what that would do is trigger what you're saying. People are going to say, are there Hawker Peddlers? Are they going to compete with us? But we as a town can say, this is the time we open it up. This is the time we close. If you don't do it, get it in for next year, because that's the time period that you can get your license. Plus, it's a funding source that you generate money during those 2 months, too.
Well, a couple things. Is it FY12? Kim and I have a joint goal, or is it FY11? To look at the Hawker Peddler's process here, as well as some of your other licenses, because it really needs a review. It's a little different than I've seen. The second thing is anybody can have a state Hawker Peddler's license, and you can't restrict anywhere that they go if they have a state license. And the third thing is you can always say no. And I think what's driving this is you're starting to get a lot of requests. And I think you have to measure, you know, how many vendors and hawkers we're going to have out there, and, you know, what we want that to look like. Mm-hmm. So I think it's reasonable to look at the, you know, how many of the same things are we offering already that, you know, we just, it's not value added at some point.
Can we increase the fees for Hawker Peddlers, or is that...
You can set whatever fee that you want that,
can we,
you know,
vary
bears
it?
Some frame of reference, I think, to what other communities are charging, but...
Can you vary it too, though? So, like, let's assume some locations are more primo than others and say, okay, this one, you know, because you're going to have more traffic, we charge more?
No, I would not suggest that.
Okay.
I think the state license fee is under $100, so...
If I may, Mr. Chairman.
Yes.
I mean, why would anyone even bother coming to us if they can just go to the state and get a...
Because you have to jump through a lot more hoops.
For the state than they do with us. Okay, so that's the reason they come before us rather than...
This is generally, it's someone who is like a balloon person and is going to every parade, mm-hmm. everything statewide. It's their primary occupation, not seasonal, those kinds of things. So it's someone who's a hawker full-time almost. So I think, you know, that's something that Kim and I are going to look at together. But I would certainly suggest that we do try to cycle them. So the ones that you're approving all go to a certain date certain, and then they all renew at one time during the year. That's perfectly appropriate.
You mentioned the Hawker State. In other words, again, I don't, just kind of making interest me. How do we know whether they have a license or not? Do they come and register? Can we force them to come and say, if I'm going to come to your town, here it is? I ask
yes,
that from a liability
the,
standpoint.
They have to go to the chief. They have to notify the chief that they're in the community. So, you know, I worked in a community where we had a parade, and the PTO and the CYO and the Boy Scouts and the Cub Scouts and the Girl Scouts all did things to earn money, and then the state hawkers would come in and completely dilute, you know, those. So that's what prompted our look at the hawkers and peddlers and stuff. But when they come in with a state license, we had a form they had to fill out, and they had to register with us. So it gets back at knowing who's in your community. You have to register with the police department.
And following up with that, if they fail to register, then can you kick them out of whatever they're doing until they register?
Yes. Yeah.
Okay.
Yes.
If I say that because whether it's parades or whether there
yes.
are other things going on, they may come in without having to do it, try to make some quick money, but we can just boot them and then tell them to go
do
it.
We had an application process. It was a one-page thing, and the chief approved it, and I signed off on it. We would waive for nonprofits in the community, but everybody had a peddler's license for that one day. Yeah.
The only thing to add to that is, can you, or first a question, can you mandate where they can do it?
I have not seen that. Which gets us back to the approval in the first place,
right?
Or the, you know, do we already have enough of the same in the community? Is it?
Well, I was saying more in terms of the state people. Can you say, look, you can do it, but you can't do it on Front Street?
I don't think so. Okay. I don't know 100%, but.
And the other thing is, when we do this analysis, it'd be great to have a map, so we could actually look at it and say, okay, we already have an ice cream truck there, and we already have a lemonade person there, so that we don't you know, and we can look at the businesses ourselves and say, okay, you're right next to Dribbles.
It's Mr. Norton.
Do we want to do something like that and wait till they come in, or do we want this board, Tricia and Tim, to try to come up with a policy for us? And I'm tossing that out to the board. You know what I mean? Do we want to treat each one individually as they come in and keep more or less the same policy, or do we want to have people look at a new policy that they can come to us with that we can either edit, change, agree with? I don't. I'm asking the question, I guess.
Question that I had to Tricia and Kim was, I know that was a priority. It's probably not a high priority, but we're done with the budget, and my thought is that something that, you know, we can start addressing? Because it goes into whether we should be looking at this in the next 30 days or 45 days to come up with something. I don't want to be redundant here and be working either across purposes between what your thoughts and what you're thinking of doing.
Well,
I think a map
we
is
haven't
a great
started
idea.
Yet, because it is FY12, isn't it?
Yes.
Yes.
And also, I should mention, in the next month or so, I did want to bring you a new license fee structure as well that I was hoping was going to be implemented for FY12. I think that's really important. I have a lot of benchmarks from other towns I'd like to present to you. So I don't know if these things can be done in concert or whether there's another one.
I think I agree with Joe. Let them do some work first and present it before we try and formulate a policy.
Yeah. Mr. Murray?
I agree completely and with what Joe and Tony are saying here, but and also just my own personal opinion, I really do like the idea of doing this on an annual basis, giving a 2-month window of time or whatever y'all think is industry standard or whatever, something along those lines. Because then also that means we can then tell the local businesses, look at the agendas for those two
right.
months. Don't worry, if you happen to go out of town in February for that week, you know, you're going to be covered.
Right.
You really, I mean, we assume that all the businesses pay rapt attention to every Board of Selectmen agenda, but they could really pay attention to those 2-month window there, knowing, okay, that's when the hawker peddlers are coming in and we need to do it. So
yeah,
I think it makes it easier for our business community. It makes it certainly easier on us. I think it tightens things up on the operation of the Selectmen's office and so on.
It's easy to disseminate information to the businesses, because if you do it ad hoc throughout the year, it's so hard, like everything else, things are
yeah.
going on. But if you know there's this window and you can say, okay, we're going to go through these hawker peddlers license, this is the time frame. And if they take an interest, they do, great. If they don't, then
yeah.
they should next year, you know.
And, you know, whenever you're able to get to it on whatever time frame, with or without the fee structure or something, I mean, it's obviously not going to be implemented at a perfect time. We'll have some people that are permitted under the old policy, and then some people that the next time they'll be permitted under the new policy. So it'll be a year of transition for everybody, but then after 1 year, we'll be on the new system. And so I think it's a good idea.
And just
Mr. Harris?
Nothing's going to happen for the season, correct? The summer season, I mean, you have right around the corner, Farmers Market. I just think it'd be hard to do or unfair to a lot of those people that, you know, at the Farmers Market, in my opinion.
Mm-hmm.
I just think this is something, I agree, let Tricia and Kim, you know, come up with a plan, but I think it would almost have to go into effect the following.
I wasn't
year.
Speaking to the Farmers Market, even though it's a hawker peddler, I was thinking more of the mobile
yes.
ones, because that was what you were discussing. I
okay.
mean, the Farmers Market is what it is, and I mean, that's part of it, but.
We could always generate a policy on farmers
yeah.
market and create a
the
new
one in North Scituate all by itself.
Called
okay,
farmers
good.
Market.
That's
and
fine.
If you're within
good.
It, that may absolve any of the outstanding issues that
good.
We have with that. We
okay.
could create something unique to that. Kim.
Excuse me. You do have two mobile food carts that are on the agenda after this discussion this evening.
I saw that.
Yep.
Yeah. This came up from because of Sands End Cafe.
Mm-hmm.
That's why I raised it, because I think the question was the competition from the hawker peddler's license that was issued, but it was issued in December, correct?
Yes. Right.
For this year. I mean,
sure.
I'm not sure we can change.
Well, we can always revisit it, right, Trish? Or is it?
I was going to say, we've got, I believe, Ms. Howard, owner of Sands End Cafe. Did you want to?
I have the
hawker's license. Okay. And you are Ann? I'm sorry? Yeah, I need your names.
Phil Matthews.
Sheila Matthews, okay. Matthews, okay.
one. So I'm confused as to your mission tonight. Is your mission to come up with language that will help you going forward so as to avoid what happened last year with allowing a hawker peddler to be within 150 yards of my business?
Yes.
Okay.
That's exactly what we're trying to address.
Even though Mrs. Matthews, is it, has been granted a license, that does not necessarily mean she or anybody will be allowed to be able to conduct business within 150 yards of mine. Is that correct?
No.
No.
It is not correct.
That's not correct.
So what does that mean then?
We issued the hawker peddler's license based upon which was submitted a year ago, and we've approved it already in December. So she is free to sell what she sold in the location she had last year, which is where it was.
So am I incorrect that at the last time I was in front of this board, the board felt that they had made an error in allowing an individual to set up a hawker peddler position within 150 yards of my business, and at that time stated to me that they would revisit the issue, that they were in error to allow that to happen, and yet you have renewed it once again?
Incorrect. We said that we had issued the hawker peddler's license, had you before us on a separate issue that we discussed, and said that we would address it again when it would come up again. Unfortunately, it was noticed. We approved her hawker peddler's license like so many others, and it was only after the fact that I actually received your email and I looked at that and said, okay, you are correct, and that I said that we'd like to address this issue. Unfortunately, though, we've already issued the license, and it's hard once you shatter the vase or let the horse out of the barn to get it back in for this year because we've granted it to her. So you are partially correct in what you're saying. But at this point, the issue now is we need to address the impact for businesses such as yours. But I can't, and I don't think the board can, turn around and say, okay, we've given your license, we're taking it back now, because we've already granted it to her.
I'm not quite sure why you can't do that, in that a year ago, you recognized that you've allowed somebody to be between the public beach and my business, a year-round business. You recognized before the public that perhaps you had made an error. You assured me that you would look at it again, and yet you did it again.
Okay, two things. I don't want to get into a debate with you on this, Ms. Howard. I did say to you, excuse me, Ms. Howe, I apologize.
Okay.
Number one, this was not an error. This board could put 10 down there in front of your office, or in front of your building, okay, your store. We could put as many as we want if the hawkers want to go down there. We have every right to do it. It's public land. We have the ability through licensing. So there's no error here. However, as I said to you last year, and I'm telling you again tonight, this was an issue that we want to try to accommodate businesses. And looking at the situation, we realized that there may be, or at least I did, there may be some direct competition here. As I said to you, we cannot now ask her to give back the license that we've already issued. However, this board is going to look into it to try to accommodate the situation so we can try to avoid it again going forward. So I realize, excuse me, I haven't finished, okay? We're trying to address the issue to try to help businesses such as yours. Unfortunately, you're correct. The license has been issued, so she has the ability to, again, sell. So,
I would ask this board, may I speak now? To recognize, as I said last year, that I pay over $8,000 a year in real estate taxes, that I employ Scituate residents, that I don't have the luxury of opening or not opening on rainy days, that I make 70% of my income in the 13 weeks of summer, and for the second year in a row, you're allowing somebody to come in and have an impact on that business. Not only do they have an impact on that business while they're doing that, because they do sell the same products that I am selling. Not only do they have that, but because they are there, and some people in the population think, why am I making such a big deal about it because you have granted them a license, I've actually had negative impact because I take the stance of protecting my business and coming to you and say, please recognize, I am a viable, ongoing, all-year-round business. The fact that you're totally disregarding that it's very difficult to do business in Hummerock, a very seasonal area, and continuing to allow a hawker peddler for $50 or whatever that license fee to be impede me and be between the beach and my business and say, we're sorry, once again, we made an error. Do you really expect us to take it back? I say, absolutely, yes, I do.
Thank you, Ms. Howard. It is not an error.
Ms. Howe.
It is not an error, okay? Let's clarify that. You want to call it an error? It's not an error. This board has every justification to issue a license and have anybody go where they want to go, okay, on town public property. So, having said that, Mr. Harris.
I remember talking to Sheila when she first approached us. It might have been outside of town hall. Her intent, and I agree with what you're saying, her intent was to teach her children some lessons about economics, about responsibility, things like that. I really don't think it was her intention to directly compete with you or any other store. I'd like to think that a compromise, you know, something can be done where she could stay where she is and maybe not overlap, sell the products that you sell. I understand what you're saying, you pay taxes, and totally agree with that. But it really was not her intention. I might have been chairman, I can't remember, but I do remember talking to her, and it was not her intention to do that. So if something can be, we can meet in the middle somehow. And I don't know if right now's the time to do it, but, you know, between now and Memorial Day, I'd like to think that both people could do business down there.
Mr. Murray.
I agree exactly with what Sean said. Were I in your position, Ms. Howe, I'd feel exactly the same way. You've been a longstanding and upstanding proprietor down there. Your cafe is an excellent place. You run an excellent business. It's one of the benchmarks of the community down there. And I think you saw the earlier discussion, which was led by the chair, about how we can address the situation moving forward is a really important point. License has been issued clearly for this coming summer, so whether it's a mistake or it's not a mistake isn't really addressing the issue going forward. I think what Mr. Harris is pointing out in terms of potentially how we could help mitigate this and minimize the impact for this coming summer, I'd be extremely interested in working some arrangement out whereby the hawker peddler in question is able to perhaps modify his or her business model such that it minimizes the impact on the San Zen Cafe, because that would really influence me greatly in this overall discussion about what to do with the hawker peddler license going forward. So the license has been issued. I support overall having hawker peddlers, particularly if it's value added, but if it's value detracted, I want to do everything we can to minimize it. You know, in the future. So I feel for you, like Mr. Harris said, and I know Mr. Danahy feels the same way because he was the guy that brought this whole larger issue up. Whether that's enough salve for this coming summer, I don't know. It would perhaps depend a lot on what Mr. Harris was suggesting, that hopefully we can work something out here.
If I might add, what is truly disheartening here as well is it's not that I came before you last year and completely forgot about it. Nor is it that I have anything personal against this family that's operating it. I too would like to teach my children and have the value of economics. However, I have been in conversation with Kim for months asking about this issue and was not once informed that the peddler's license had already been issued. In fact, I was told that tonight was the night to come to discuss it. So I am truly amazed that it was already issued, even though I've had numerous conversations. And additionally, she let me
I'm not gonna, Ms. Howe, I'm not gonna have you come in here and start bashing our town employees.
I'm not bashing.
No, you are, because the issue, no, listen. The license was issued in December, okay? It was duly noticed and notified. It was put on the website, it was put outside, and you know what? The long and short of it is, you didn't see it. Now, the simple fact is, it was issued to Ms. Matthews. We can't, excuse me, Ms. Howe, if you're going to interrupt me, we're done discussion. We're done with this issue. I brought this up for your benefit to try to figure out how we're going to address this issue. I'm happy to move on now. So if you're here to start criticizing the town employee who actually has been trying to figure out how to address this policy after dealing with the budget issues that we've had, after the impact of the storm, you know what? I'm done, okay?
Criticism's intended.
All right, then let's move on.
I was stating the fact that we had several email communications, and I am just dismayed that in our several communications, it was never once revealed to me that the peddler's license had already been issued.
Do you think she was hiding it from you on purpose? Is that what you're trying to suggest here by implicitly saying it? Well, enough said, because you know what? She wasn't hiding anything. We're done with this discussion. Is there anybody else who wants to talk on it? Fair enough. We're done. Thank you. Okay. Next agenda item.
This gentleman does.
We're done. Next agenda item. A discussion vote on a Hawker Peddler's mobile cart vendor's license, Dell's Lemonade. Is there somebody from Dell's?
Yes.
Thank you.
Mr. Chair, just as a reminder, earlier on the sister city thing was moved, but we still need to address that at some point.
Tonight?
Tonight.
Just do it.
All right. Just as a reminder. I don't think she's here yet. She's here yet, but just as a reminder, the crossing
okay,
things
you
off.
Haven't put
it
on.
Move later on the agenda.
Yeah, sure.
Could you identify yourself, please?
Hi, Susan Franklin.
Ms. Franklin, good evening. You're looking for a Hawker Peddler's license. You've been before us before on Dell's Lemonade.
Yes, I have.
And what are you looking for specifically?
Well, in the past, we've only used our mobile carts here in Scituate for both the Heritage Days Festival and Scituate Shore Run and things like that. But we've obtained a truck, which I brought a picture of, but it's pretty much a ice cream truck.
Kind of a configuration. And it makes it a little easier for us. Because
Could you please give one to Ms. Donovan as well? Ms. Franklin.
Sure.
Thank you. Tony and I could share here.
Anyway, our carts weigh about 1,000 pounds, and they're very difficult to move on and off the trailer that we have to use to move them around. So for certain locations, like beaches, it's easier to have the truck. The cart's great for heritage days and things like that, where we put it down and leave it down for 6-7 hours at a time.
So let me, okay. Right now you have one cart or two carts? What do you have?
We have two carts.
And how many carts do you operate in Scituate?
Only one.
Only on certain events.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Now, is this in addition to, or is this something? Is this in addition to the carts that you're looking to do, or is this just in place of the carts?
No, we would probably still use the carts at Heritage Days because we think it makes more sense. But for beaches and things like that, it's easier for us to drive up, service the customers, and drive away. Right.
Mr. Norton.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Chairman. So your intention with the truck would be to go to beaches primarily in the summer.
That's right.
And then the events would be throughout the year.
The events would still likely be cart opportunities. Yeah. I think maybe the shore run might be the truck because it doesn't have the population that we get at, mm-hmm. say, Heritage Days, mm-hmm. and even the farmers market. We're anticipating, you know, more time on the ground. Stay in one place. Kind
You're of. In the farmer's market also, right?
Yes.
Yes, that's right. Yep. Thank you. So it's primarily beaches.
Mr. Harris?
Do you operate this truck now?
We just obtained it.
All right.
We're going to start operating it. We've gotten permitted in Cohasset, and I'm going before Hingham next after you.
The only reason I ask, it's, you know, about our policy. I know you operate at events, mm-hmm. and that's a little bit different, but the policy that we were just talking about earlier tonight that was voted 12 years ago or so was really geared more towards these types of vehicles at the beaches, 15 minutes and within so many feet of stores that sell these products, things like that.
Yes, a couple of years ago you allowed me to do the carts.
To bring the cart around to
the beaches?
Beaches. All right.
But we
okay.
found it was very All difficult
right.
to manage
All right.
just because
okay.
you'd have to keep picking it up and moving it around.
All right.
This is part of the whole problem because, just to go back to the last issue, she could drive her truck down to the and next to Humrock Beach and park it there, you know, five, six times on the weekend or per day. And again, it would create the whole, you know, competitive.
I don't think she could, because actually here for an ice cream vendor, which I'd qualify this as being frozen lemonade, she cannot do it within 1/4 mile of any business which sells ice cream. So
she can't.
She can't sell within 1/4 mile of the Sands End Cafe or Scotty's, and
mine
it doesn't have one, so you wouldn't have a problem there.
A 1/4 mile from Peggotty, I bet you Dribbles is within 1/4 mile of Peggotty.
Very close. I mean, that's why, you know, I think you're probably right. It's very close to it. I wonder whether.
I wonder whether it has to be looked at in totality.
Exactly.
Absolutely.
What I'm trying to put together. It's just.
And not, you know, I don't know. When do you plan on starting? Memorial Day?
Generally, we do. Yeah. Memorial Day, Columbus Day.
You know, it probably really doesn't get too busy until after school's out, I would imagine.
Right, frankly, July 4th and on is when it really picks up.
So that may give us enough time. Tricia, what do you think? Is that enough time for us to get some sort of arms around this or no?
Well, I mean, I'm sensitive to the fact that it's Memorial Day. I mean, at the exclusion of some other things. What's their second meeting in May?
Well, I would say even till June. I would say, you know, if we dealt with it by the time school got out, I mean, the beaches are not very active until then, before we add to the existing potential problem. And let it be known that, you know, Tricia made a good point. She could go to the state tomorrow and get a license and do whatever she wants, just like anybody could do. So.
Well, I do have a state license, but I would not do that. Yeah. It's not good for my business to be.
Well, right. And I think it's our responsibility to come up with some sort of solid foundation of what is a fair policy for the people in town. And that doesn't mean one way or the other. I don't know where it'll fall. You know, it's, but.
I think we can, I mean, we're not reinventing the wheel. We'll contact a number of communities. And this is something we've been sensitive to, which is why we have it. It's one of Kim's goals for FY12,
right,
to work with me to look at this as well as the entertainment licenses, because you haven't, and there are some different things going on here. So I think we can endeavor to do something sooner than later in the latter part of your May meeting, hopefully, because I'm not here in June. So it's got to be then or never. So.
And even if it's not a final, at least, as you're wording, get our arms around it, because some constraints to move in the right direction here.
And not necessarily constraints.
Constraints in the verbatim of a policy is what I mean, not constraints necessarily. I can't vote on this given all the balls in the air right now, much as I love Dell's Lemonade, which I really do. But given the discussions we were just having and our overall concern, I can't assess this right now.
Why don't we do this? Kim, what's our first meeting in June?
I believe it's June 7th.
June 7th. So why don't we plan on targeting, can we put that in as an agenda item, okay?
Tricia, you won't be here for that meeting?
That's okay, though. I mean, I'm going to endeavor to do it sooner than that, but if not, Kim can handle it. I mean, it's going to be a policy that for your review anyway.
Okay. So what we'll do is we'll have it planned for June 7th.
Okay.
And then probably would it be possible then to have hawker peddlers such as, I forget your name.
Oh, Susan Franklin.
Ms. Franklin here. To come in later in the agenda. By then, we should have formulated what our policy is, I presume.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
Okay, great.
So we're not denying it, but we're not approving it.
I understand.
All at the same time.
I understand.
All right.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thanks a lot.
Which brings us to the next hawker peddler's license. Come on up. I think Ms. Robitaille and Mr. Newsom, you're looking for a mobile. Also,
at the ball fields.
At the ball fields. Okay.
And through the year, we do other events as well. And what we were led to believe was if we went for the hawker peddler with the town, Jennifer would only have to do one inspection, and we would therefore only have to pay one inspection fee. Given we've been doing individual inspections for all of the events that we've been doing throughout the town. we've been paying fees on an individual event basis.
Gentlemen, how do you feel?
That's interesting.
I'm
a question.
Yes.
Your application here says that your menu changes all the time?
It changes per event. Like if we go to Heritage Days, and I know because I do the food vendors for Heritage Days, I know that if there's like five hot dog people there, I'm not going to do hot dogs. I'll change it up and do something different.
But all the food items that you sell off the cart, Jennifer is inspecting for?
Right.
So you give her, so
I
in
give
any
her
given
an
event, let's say you're selling
time,
six
yeah.
things,
yeah.
but you, she's inspecting you for 12 or whatever. You know what I'm saying? You're
yeah.
inspected for
have,
every potential food item you
right.
may vend.
Right.
Okay, thanks.
Yeah.
That was my
but my menus would never be as extensive as that for, like to go to the ball fields,
right.
I would
that
never
was
do
my,
all,
right.
I would just only do hamburgers and hot dogs, maybe chili if it's a cold day and, or chowder until it gets warm.
That was my question because
yeah.
it wasn't clear
and,
from
and
that.
And beverages, that's
yeah.
it, like
Thank
hot
you.
Coffee, cold coffee.
You're not looking to go down to the Greenbush ball field? It's the ball fields, the Greenbush, which is
I'm
down.
I'm looking at the one on Beaver Dam and Central Fields, right,
okay.
Right up the street from the store.
I got you. Okay. That's what I just wanted to find out.
Yeah.
Mr. Harris?
Did we just, and I, you know, it's great, but did we just grant one for the ball fields?
Yes.
Yeah.
We did. Are you aware of that?
No.
Yeah, we just did.
For Cole Parkway, and she also specified.
Mm-hmm. And the problem, I think I mentioned at the last meeting, you know, sometimes this runs into fundraising activities
yep.
of Little League or,
right.
You know, different Cooper's, you know, different things who are trying to raise money for their
Which we've
thing.
Spoken about doing in conjunction with them. But we still need the license.
No, I'm, there's people there selling, getting a license
right.
to sell hot dogs
okay,
at
yeah.
the games.
As a fundraiser.
As a fundraiser.
As a fundraiser,
yeah,
right.
So, I would say that this probably has to be, until we get our arms around what we're going to do, this is still,
same.
You know, conflicting.
Okay.
June.
Problem is that if you're doing baseball.
Yeah, I know. I don't know.
We had a request from several people to do the ball field at Beaver Dam.
Oh,
so.
No, yeah.
And somebody just did it a couple weeks ago.
I have no, okay. Maybe what we're going to be looking at is June, okay, for a next discussion on this. We'll keep you on the agenda for your license. I think what we need to do is look at this issue of competitiveness. You know, if you have two different carts at the same place, I get you. You know, that's potentially a problem. You know, and how do you, or do you specify specific, it's at, you
fields.
Know, at this is your field and that's it. But then you raised an issue, Tricia, that the state doesn't mandate that or does not legislate
that,
it.
I don't know.
We have to
I don't know.
But
I
the
mean,
town, we may or may not be within our right to do it. I'm not sure.
That I don't
another
know.
Whole another issue.
I mean, if I looked at a policy, I would like the board, if possible, have the flexibility to give preference to Scituate.
Residents.
Business
yeah, I agree.
Owners and residents,
correct.
As opposed to some you've approved from,
correct.
You know.
I absolutely
I mean,
agree.
I see it very much as what we went through with the special events. You just kept getting this plethora of requests for events, and we're responding to them on a case-by-case basis, and we need to step back and look at it globally. And as Tony said, map what's approved now and sort of get it on a cycle of comprehensive review and approvals so that now, you know, I can do some special events because they're repeats.
Right.
And it becomes more of a routine function than sort of this aching review that, you know, you're trying to give every consideration to because you don't have the foundation and a policy that you previously had that needs to be expanded, I think.
Can you wait till June 7th? I know you probably don't want to, but frankly, you're going to have to.
We're at the mercy of the board. What
okay.
can I say?
And we all just want to add, this says nothing to do with your store or your quality of what you've been offering and what you're going to be able to offer and all that sort of stuff. This is just we're in a transition here, whether it's special events, whether it's
well,
figuring
as
out
I
these
say,
things.
I'm
we're
here
just codifying this,
simply,
and here
simply
you are.
To simplify this, and because we were requested by somebody very special to please do the ball field on Beaver Dam.
Yep.
No, we understand, but just so you understand where we're coming from, so thank you.
We'll make sure, Kim, again, if we can put them with Ms. Franklin.
And again, just like I said, since we do everything on an individual basis, we pay an inspection fee for every one of those. Maybe if it was, I mean, it really wouldn't matter to me about the ball fields, okay, but it was by request, several requests. The inspection fees are every event, and like, I don't mind supporting the town, but.
Well, we'll see if we can, instead of doing it, we'll see if we can get it with one Hawker peddler's license.
That would be great.
I think the way you've applied it right now would make sense that you would avoid.
And that's why I do it, and I also want to institute a program where we can work with the Little League, the Farm League, the
T-ball.
Pop Warner, and the high school called to see if we were available. This would be something that we could do to help them make some money, because I know this is really tough for families of students right now. So, and to help them make money. I'm kind of involved in that, invested my life in that.
Thank you, Marcia. Thank you, Bob.
Very appreciated.
One last comment, and I know you guys will take this into consideration, but Greenbush and Roach Field on Beaver Dam, the parking there is completely packed at game time, and puts, you know, especially during transition for game. I don't know how we would accommodate, you know, we have to think about how you would accommodate a vehicle in there when it's a log jam already. You know, just something else to think about. Where, you know, we may have to designate that you park here.
Right. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, folks. I have one question. I wonder how, when we do a fair or something, we have to be licensed and we have to be insured so we cover fairgrounds. How's that work in the town when the parents for football come in and they buy their hot dogs at Stop and Shop or something, and they're not licensed? And who gets the exposure here if someone says they got poisoned?
Bob, I hate to say it, that's a discussion for another day.
Yeah, right.
Okay. We can talk about that. I got to move the agenda along. Thank you. All right. Agenda item number 7, which I think it was 7.
This is the
Soucian Brie. Is it a 4?
I think it's 4.
I've got the wrong agenda here. Where'd my agenda go?
It was renumbered, Mr. Chair.
Did I tell you?
Yes, you did. That's it right there. Okay, thank you.
It's renumbered, so.
Which is agenda item. Do I have the right one?
Yeah, it was 4. We moved it to 6.
Yeah.
Yes.
And we jumped it
agenda
just
4.
For time
now
purposes.
It's 6. Ms. Jacquard, do you mind coming on up? Thank you. You've missed all the fireworks. Absolutely. If you'd like, actually, John, if she puts it over here, can the, Pat, if you could put it over here so that the television people can see it.
Yeah.
Does that help, John? Or how about an easel? That would be great.
Would that help?
Can you get that?
Yeah, I'm sure you can get there.
Good. Thank you, John. And our technician back there, his name? Zach. Thank you, Zach. Pat, welcome. Welcome back from France.
Thank you. It's good to be
and,
back.
And it's good to see you. You wanted to address the board and tell us what's been going on since that eventful travel in February.
Well, I really appreciate your support, the support of the town for this endeavor. And I think we're moving along. Already planning things for this summer, I think beyond what we had anticipated last fall when we signed the original intent to create this association. So I wanted to come here tonight just to keep, to update everyone about what happened as briefly as I can over in Soucian Brie in February and what we're planning for this summer. So between February 20th and March 4th, 41 students and 5 teachers plus 2 additional delegates from the town of Scituate were hosted by families in Soucian Brie. The students were students from Scituate High School and Cohasset High Schools, and they were there on an exchange. We had already participated. The French had come here in October, as many of you know, and that's when we signed that intent to create this Sister City Association. We also had, so that was 2 weeks, and then we also had, really, which added so much to the trip, we had Richard Bowen, town moderator, and William Clark, who was the president of the Rotary Club, who came as official delegates. We were hoping to have Mr. Danahy come with us, but he did videotape a speech, and that was played at the very beginning of the formalization ceremony that we had for the Sister City Association. Now I'm happy to see, and I hope all of you have seen the banner that's flying out in front of Town Hall, and I really appreciate the fact that that is there. That was the first thing we saw when we arrived in Sucy-en-Brie, right in the center of town, along with a huge billboard welcoming all of us to Sucy, and that flew the entire time. We also, these are pictures that were taken when the group was here in Scituate, and these were in almost every store in the center of Sucy-en-Brie. I'll just show these back here. But things that they felt were very typical of the association. There was also a big sign, where it says here, the signing of the pact, that was on a big sign in town, and all of the members of the town were invited to attend. So on, while we were there for 5 days, I was also lucky enough to be one of the official delegates. So I, for part of the time, I was doing town business instead of school business. And we were thoroughly shown all of the major sites that Sucy has to offer. The president of the Chamber of Commerce of Sucy and a number of city council men and women served as our guides for all of this. And so for 5 days, every day we were out seeing all kinds of very interesting sites. And I will say I had seen some of these before. But for Richard and William, this was their first visit to France, and certainly to Sucy-en-Brie, and I think they were really very impressed by what they saw, and were very eager to come back, and they've already started talking to people about the trip and all the great possibilities that there are for Scituate. So just to list a few of the things that we loved. First of all, we loved the people. Everyone we met was so friendly, and we loved everything we saw. Sucy is a town of 25,000 people. It's on the train line, direct line into Paris, so it takes less than a half an hour to get into the center of Paris. I didn't really know this, but because I stayed with somebody the last two times outside of Sucy, and I just took a quick route to the school when we met every day. But it has ponds, rivers, gorgeous parks, so lots of green spaces that everybody takes advantage of. It has beautiful architecture for the houses, but as well as the historical buildings, and there are even more modern buildings. We visited four chateaus. One of them is the town hall, a smaller sized one, but another one is one that was decorated for visits by, I think he made one visit, Louis XIV. And it is now the music conservatory, and we were given a private concert. We hope to have the woman who, she's a renowned pianist, who's the director of the conservatory, and we really hope that we can have something on the South Shore sometime within the next year. There is a charming medieval center to the town that winds its way up to the top of a hill. There's a 13th century church that sits on the top of it. There's also a 19th century fort that we visited, and it hosts all kinds of, it's very well preserved, and hosts a lot of events, including the fact that they have a shooting range, and all of us were invited to participate in that. There's a vineyard. The grapes are harvested every year, and I was told to extend an invitation in the fall if any of you would like to go, and it's a town-wide event. And so the townspeople harvest the grapes, and then they others produce the wine. I do have a bottle of wine for you, John, sent by people of Sucy. There are many small businesses, a few large businesses, and an open-air market that's open 2 days a week. So I think it typifies when we think of a European town, and particularly a French town, it's everything that you would think of. In addition to some nice restaurants, a lot of wonderful cooks, so we really did have a wonderful time. On March 1st, we signed the official pact with Sucy-en-Brie. We had done the intent last October, and this was now in their cultural center in town, and 500 people from the town came to this event, and students from the Music Conservatory played. The entire time that the ceremony was going on with different speeches, beautiful photographs of Scituate were being displayed above the speakers. They were all taken by the French delegates when they were here last fall. Several different speeches. We started with John Danahy's speech, which everyone really liked and appreciated, and then Richard Bowen gave a speech in French. One of our students, Brendan Horgan, spoke on behalf of all the American students in French. And naturally, the mayor spoke as well, and I did, and also one of the council members. At the end of the evening, there was a resounding by the adult band that they played our national anthem and the Star-Spangled Banner, of course, and the Marseillaise, and everyone was very touched by that. And then there was a nice champagne reception for all 500 people that were there. So that was one of the highlights of our trip. And I know that we went home leaving behind many, many residents of Sucy-en-Brie who are very eager to get to know Scituate a lot better and to coordinate with us on all kinds of future exchanges. We do know that we have to start out on the small side at first, and so the events that we're planning for the immediate future involve more young people visiting Scituate that didn't have the opportunity to participate in the official exchange that we have. So in July, from July 10th to the 24th, 12 students from Sucy-en-Brie, probably 17 or 18 years of age, are coming, and they're going to be having a language stay in Scituate. We have a teacher, one of our town members, who is going to teach English in the morning, and then in the afternoon we have another woman from the town who's going to be accompanying the students on excursions in the area. We have already a lot of volunteers from both Cohasset and Scituate to lead very local types of things like lobstering and sort of an ecological coastal visit and some things like that, in addition to going into Boston. So the one thing I'm happy to be broadcasting tonight or announcing is that we are looking for families to host, and we already have some volunteers. It's for 2 weeks, as I mentioned, July 10th through the 24th. The responsibilities for the families would be mostly in the evening and on the weekends, because they'll be involved and things are planned for them during the day. There are also three other slightly older students who are coming, college age, who are interested in a homestay, and would be offering a homestay back in France anytime the hosting family would want to do this. And finally, in addition, the only other two that I know of that are coming are Reba Restaurant has offered to take two trainees from the culinary school in Sucy-en-Brie, and if they can get the paperwork, because it is a special visa to come over here. So if they can do that. If we can't get it done this year, we hope to be able to work towards that in the future, where our young people can go over and do types of internships and that they can come here. So that's basically what we're planning for the summer, and then we hope to do more artistic, musical, or sports-related events next year. And we have a sister city committee that the town organized, and we have already met since our return, and we have determined to create an association that is a South Shore Sister City Association with tax-free status that in that way, we would become a part of that association, but other towns that might have a sister city relationship could also be involved with that. And I'd just like to conclude by urging everyone in Scituate to think about taking advantage of such a wonderful opportunity. Even if they, if you don't speak French, it's still a wonderful opportunity to meet people that you normally would not meet. And most of the time, a trip over there would really be the cost of the plane ticket and not much more. And the same for them when they come here.
Can we get the Scituate Mariner to make sure that they put that in? Be very helpful. Good.
Thank you.
Questions from the board?
Just a comment, Mr. Chairman, if I may, and you know, we see this all happening now in the past couple of months, but Pat's been probably close to 2 years ago, started this product process, or started the ball rolling, and I think that has to be recognized. There was a lot of behind-the-scenes work that was done prior to going to France or having friends come here, so thanks to you.
Well, you're welcome. It's been a pleasure.
Yes.
Other gentlemen?
No, great.
Pat, thank you very much. Okay.
We have the pictures on the website.
Oh, good.
And if you give me the details, we can send out a web blast for host families.
Okay.
I think that's
that
appropriate.
That would be great.
And do you have an anticipated date when they're coming here July 10th through 24,
24.
Is there a date in the future where you expect another Scituate delegation to go over?
We, John and I talked about that. We haven't really set up the date, but I did tell the council members in Suzanne Brie that we were looking forward to that, and that would be, you know, when we can talk about it, we would arrange something.
Okay.
At that point. So, no, that's wonderful. And then my next thing I would just say to everybody is to stay tuned. We are hoping Marie Flaherty is going to help us with a website, and I'd like to talk to, I guess it's Tom Rose, is it?
Yep.
To get that set up. And also the teacher, Beth Marat from Cohasset, has her own kind of web page and whatnot that's would be working with us as well. And I think once we can get that up and running, get well known.
Good.
So.
That's excellent.
Thank you.
All right. Thank you
very
much. I appreciate all your support.
Would like to probably move back then to the meet the applicants agenda item number 7.
They're up,
gotten
yeah.
Pretty quiet in the hall. John, could you just ask if they could come in?
You sure about wine, Mr. Denny?
It's town wine.
Remember when you bring something to class,
we're going to put
it in enough to share.
Folks, come on up. I'll tell you what, if you could grab some chairs, we'll have you sit right around the table up here. I think there are 5 of you. So come on up. Sorry to keep you waiting. We actually came to you earlier on, and everybody wasn't here, so we ended up going further into the agenda, and now getting back to you, sometimes it's a little more difficult. But if I could ask you to introduce yourselves as we go around, so that not only the people on the board, but the audience and also TV could recognize who you are.
Do you want to stand?
No, you can sit down. That's
Bill
fine.
Logan, 15, Morrison Lane.
Ben Morrison, 60 Mordecai.
Trish Dooling, 53 Marshall Avenue, Egypt Beach.
Welcome.
And Victor Milligan, 10 Border Street.
Chris McConaughey, 3 Linden Avenue.
Folks, thank you very much for coming. Two of the members couldn't make it. One was coaching my daughter in baseball, and the other gentleman couldn't make it, but we've had him before with respect to the Pier 44. Wanted to have you introduce yourselves to us. I understand you've been through a selection process with the planning board. 7 applicants were brought to us by both the chair, Mr. Limbacher, and also Mr. Daniel Monger. And so kind of wanted to just kind of meet the board and also maybe ask you some questions. So I'll ask the board if any questions they have of any of these applicants that the planning board has recommended. Mr. Norton.
Just to, you know, I think this goes without saying, and I think you all are well aware of it, that's why you're here. Now, this committee or this whole idea has become so much more important in the past few years, shall we say. It's probably long overdue. One of the big criticisms or concerns of people, you know, is that we just don't have a commercial base here in Scituate. And there are a lot of good reasons why we don't. But I guess it's the economic times have just, we've gotten to the point where we have to just step outside the box and look at different alternatives or different areas, because the way things are going financially, we just cannot exist without a broader financial base. How we're going to get there, I guess that's why you're here. But it's so important. Thanks very much for jumping in and filling this big void. So.
Yeah, just I read all the resumes. They're very impressive. You know, we've got great background and great marketing and sales and city planner and, you know, people that have started and been on other economic committees in other towns. I think it's a great group. And we discuss these issues every year. We get together and talk about big picture things and how we can do it. But, you know, we're hoping to reach out to you guys and have you guys go out of the box a little bit in terms of what we're thinking about. The only thing that I saw in the grouping is a lot of you are pretty new to Scituate. 3 years, 5 years, I don't think there was any really long-term residence here. And that was, and I didn't see anyone here I would replace, but I was just wondering if there was any consideration, probably I guess more to Dan and Bill, in terms of having someone that has been through it a little bit, knows Scituate a little bit better than, you know, has been here for 20 years or whatever and kind of knows the ropes a little bit more. Was that?
Yeah, we really considered everything. Yeah. And we had such an amazing applicant pool. I mean, yeah. It was unbelievable. I think you guys went through the same thing with Pier 44. It was very difficult to decide. I mean, we had 19 highly qualified applicants, and I think we all sort of agreed. You could have thrown a dart, you know, to dartboard and picked any one of those 19. It would have been a great committee. But at the end of the day, you know, we evaluated. I think you have the evaluation sheets we use.
Very intense.
We started a very analytical process looking for certain qualities, and we also thought about how different skills would fit on the committee and having a kind of a variety of skills, not everyone looking identical. But at the end of the day, we used our score sheets and we averaged it, and this is what came out. And I think, you know, in general, you know, we were very pleased with the high quality we got.
That really wasn't, I mean, I think the group is phenomenal. I looked at all the resumes and I was impressed. Added, I just didn't, was 7 the number you were looking for?
Yes.
Is that the working number that you think is the best?
Yeah. Actually, we started out with 5 initially, and then we thought, well, what if we get a lot of applicants?
Right.
We don't want to exclude anybody, so we went to 7, and I think 2 weeks before the deadline for the applications, we only had a small handful, and we all kind of went into panic mode, and a lot of people went out recruiting people and everything, but the week before the applications were due, you know, we had a flood of applicants coming, and went up to 19, and we held a 2 very long marathon meetings, you know, interviewing every applicant, was there for a good 20 to 30 minutes, had great conversations. You wouldn't believe the quality of ideas coming out of everyone.
Well, a lot of them were written here. It was
fantastic.
I have to say, you know, we've talked about this a lot, and I get a kick because I was reading through your applications and between the various ideas, and I found that it's intriguing, you know, that obviously everybody hit the same thing. The business base isn't large here, and of course there are a lot of reasons for that. With your backgrounds, being able to identify, okay, well, these are potential solutions. Branding by Mr. Mulligan, which I thought was really intriguing and very important to try to identify because of the nature of the town. And I liked Ms. Dooling's suggestion, water park. Great idea. I mean, I thought there should be a casino down in Hummer Rock. That way, you know, we put everybody through Marshfield and get all the revenue without having to worry about the costs for the infrastructure. That's what it's going to take. And I think the other thing I identified with all your responses is that this isn't going to happen overnight. It's going to take 10 years, you know, and it's trying to set up goals to get there. And the problem is that people come in and go, and you hopefully can identify 3A, is that the location, and how are we going to save charm here? There's wetland issues, but you're going to vet that out and focus on it. And, you know, as opposed to whether it's this board or the planning board, the difficulty you run into is that other issues come up, so you can't just keep focusing on this. You're a focus group that's going to be looking at potentials for the town going forward. And You know, I wish we could do that, but we have so many other issues, as you probably heard earlier, dealing with business, dealing with this, dealing with budgeting. And, you know, it's the same with the planning. You know, they've got developments that come in that interfere with long-term plans, and it's the logistics and the economy. So I'm really excited about it. I'm anxious to see how it progresses in the next, and I tell you, I'm not saying a year, I mean the next 2 years, because it's really a long-term thought process here. And it's taken about a year to get you constituted, but there's a reason for it. Because if we do a knee-jerk response and just get somebody on board, we're going to end up with, you know, what you get. And this, your backgrounds, you know, are pretty impressive. Yeah. So, Mr. Murray.
Great group of applicants. Thank you very much. I mean, really, you're putting your neck out, you guys and the two people that aren't here, and it's going to take a lot of work. With all this discussion of overrides and living within means and all these other, you know, rhetoric. And you can't make our numbers work just by cutting. You can't make our numbers work by, you know, other means. The fundamental problem is the tax base, the revenue coming in. It's just revenue. And so I just ask you a couple things. One is everything on the table, from my perspective, at least. I mean, within reason, obviously, right? I mean, we don't preserve the character of the town. That's why we're all here. That's why you all moved here at whatever time frame you did. That's why we all are here. Preserve the character of the town to the extent feasible, but everything's on the table from my perspective. I'm very pro-environment, as you all know, but there's ways that you can work these things in. Also, as Mr. Harris was telling me earlier about the waterfront, you know, really take a close look at the waterfront and the boaters. I don't know if any of you guys are boaters in particular, but there's some strong boating community in town. There's a strong boating community outside of town. These transients come in, they drop their coin, and they go away. They're great. All right, and there's some things that we can probably do to encourage that. And then lastly, as Mr. Danahy just said, it's not gonna be a short fix problem. On the other hand, I'd be interested in if there's any low-hanging fruit you come across and you say, God, you know, there's some bylaw or there's something here that written 20 years ago, completely inadvertently shutting us out of some opportunities, that you're reasonably comfortable making a relatively rapid change, feeling that that won't negatively, adversely affect us 2 or 3 years down the road. If there's any low-hanging fruit, by all means, everything's welcome. But go for it, and thanks again for your time.
I want to thank Bill and certainly Dan for putting that together with the planning board, all, as well as the other members. I know you're taking time to sit down to go through all the applications and interviews. It's not an easy task. We've gone through it ourselves.
It's a fun task, and the fact that everyone has, I think they live in town the same reason that we do, and it's the nature, I think, Rick, you hit on it. It's the town itself, and I think that there's the interest is there, and I think that the creativity is there, not only individually but collectively as a group. So I anticipate great things.
Just be creative. Be creative.
Yeah, hey. We want to thank all of you. I mean, your support on this has been obviously critical, and, you know, it's a team effort putting this together, and so fantastic to have the leadership of the town behind this and all your great ideas to help make this happen. It's a fantastic effort, I think, and I think it bodes well for the town in the future.
Mr. Harris.
I just was going to thank everyone as well. Rick just touched on it. Just like to expand on it. If, you know, most of the group is new in town, you chose to come to Scituate for different reasons. Many of us have never left town for those same reasons. What would you do to this town so your children, after they go off to school, would come back and stay in this town?
That's a good way of putting it.
Scituate, you know, I think about this stuff almost every single day. Scituate's unique, but it's not. It's very similar to Marshfield and Cohasset in a lot of ways. When I was growing up in this town, around the holidays, you never had to go beyond Scituate Harbor to do all your shopping. Then when the Hanover Mall was built, that was the place to go. And you see what's happened down to Marshfield, down there in their downtown district. It's, you know, unfortunately, it's been all done over, but it seems like it's, you know, desolate, you know, and that's how, what do you do to, you know, I don't know, you get quite a challenge, but these resumes are awesome, the background and, you know, reading through it. You know, we have the ocean on the other side. There's not, you know, as Rick said, you have to get, you know, especially creative, and that's just Memorial Day through Labor Day. So, and someone else said it earlier, it's not a short-term solution, that's for sure. So exciting. See what you come up with. Good luck.
Do you have questions of us? We're interviewing you, but any questions?
Just be patient with us.
Yeah, we will. Folks, thank you very much. We're going to vote on your...
Feel free to call us.
Your questions. Applications. The next agenda item, I guess, the appointment process. So you're welcome to stay. Otherwise, we'll move on to the next agenda item.
Another applicant, John?
Thanks.
What's that?
Another applicant, maybe?
Yes, indeed. Thank you very much.
She's the child you're talking about.
Thank you.
Thank you, folks.
Thank you.
Good luck.
See ya.
Good luck.
Night.
Agenda item number 10, appointments. And it's for the Cable Television Committee, Economic Development Committee, and the Sister City Committee, I guess.
Move the Board of Selectmen appoint David Givens to the Sister City Committee.
Second.
Seconded by Mr. Harris. Discussion? Seeing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Congratulations.
Move the Board of Selectmen appoint Tracy Kitty, Donald Smart, Dan Taylor as associate members of the Cable Television Committee.
Second.
Seconded by Mr. Norton. Further discussion? Seeing none, all in favor? Aye.
Aye.
Unanimous. And finally.
Move the Board of Selectmen appoint Bill Logan, Colin McNeese, Jennifer Morrison, Victor Milligan, Trish Dooling, Jack Gates, Chris McConaughey to the to be members of the Economic Development Committee. I'm sorry. Can I scratch that motion? Let me start all over.
Sure.
Move the Board of Selectmen appoint Bill Logan to a 3-year term, Colin McNeese to a 3-year term, Jennifer Morrison to a 3-year term, Victor Milligan to a 2-year term, Trish Dooling to a 2-year term, Jack Gates to a 1-year term, and Chris McConaughey to a 1-year term of the Economic Development Committee.
Second.
Seconded by Mr. Norton. Further discussion?
Just one quick, you know, is there a need for any associate members to this? I mean, I'm just a little bit concerned about, you know, and not concerned, that's the wrong word, but would someone with more knowledge of the town be helpful to the committee, or is it best to let them get their feet wet and then talk about it later? I mean, 7 people's a lot, but I'm looking at some of the other people here that have been in town for quite a while that may be able to add something.
That's a good point.
You know. I'll defer to the rest of the board what your thoughts are. I mean, I think you can do that.
Or maybe,
that makes sense.
Maybe
I
Dan.
Think, you know, you could also you know, let the board go or the committee go as is, as constituted. You got the planning board, they got to refer, what do you call it? Not review back, but report back. That's the word I want. And as well as this board that they have to report back. And their findings are not going to be finalized unless it's a joint decision by both boards. I just hate to add more people to it just for the sake of it, given that, you know, I realize you're concerned, but I look at the board here and I'm like, only one of us is actually a native townie. All 4 of us actually have moved here over the course of time. So I think, you know, I just don't see the validity of that issue to some degree. I think, you know, they're going to have good input.
I
just wondering if we will probably be sending out letters to the group that was not picked tonight. And I'm just thinking that in that letter, it's a public meeting, so anyone's... could we not mention the fact that it is a public meeting and their expertise is more than welcome, whether they you know, which they can attend whether they get this letter or not. I mean, it's just...
Right.
Vignani was before.
Yeah, sure. Yep. I just want to clarify one thing. I don't think it's a concern. I just think it's going to be added, a potential added value. I think this group is going to do great. I'm just wondering if more input from another area would be helpful. Maybe some of you think it won't. Maybe we need fresh thoughts without somebody saying, oh, we were going to put a hockey rink there 25 years ago. I don't know.
Mr. Murray?
I agree with both Tony and Joe on this. But my feeling is it's an open meeting. I do think the letter should say, as Mr. Norton suggested. You know, these things sort of work themselves out. If there's a dedicated group of 3 or 4 other individuals who are not members of the committee and they show active involvement and participation and so on and so forth, then 6 months from now or a year from now, if you guys find it's important, then, you know, we could reconsider it at that point. Additionally, despite the best intentions, maybe one of these seven members or something has a change in their work status where they can't put as much time in as they are anticipating or something like that, and we've got a good bench to choose from at that point. But right now, I'd be hesitant to sort of add to it, just thinking it through. So that's where I fall on this one.
Any further discussion? Mr. Limbacher?
A letter going out, the planning board would be happy to do that. With all the people, expect some emails that have gone out indicating, but we can come back and formalize that and then come back and indicate that obviously that their input. Dan indicated you could have taken any one of the candidates and made a committee out of any group of those.
Yeah. And some of these appointments are just for a year, right? Because you appropriately staggered it, which is good. And then you're going to be putting together an email distribution list. It's going to go out on the town anyways, but you could also add some of these people to the email distribution list if they're so interested, or make sure that they're on the town list so they would get due public notification.
I think the legacy and the history of the town is going to be pretty well represented because they're going to interface with the planning board, with the board of selectmen, but they're also going to be working with a lot of the other committees that you guys have appointed that are out there. Recreation or whatever group that they are, so they're there. So there's always going to be that tie-in on it. But they're also unencumbered as to, well, geez, we tried that in 1933 and it didn't work, and we tried it again in 58, right? We almost tried it in 71. I mean, that's nice to know as the history, and I guess I enjoy history as much as anybody, but I think they're unencumbered by that. As Rick said, you know, everything is on the table.
I was just going to add, at the end of the day, I mean, they are an advisory committee. You know, they're required to come back to the selectmen and come back to the planning board. And as you know, the significant in town goes through town meetings. So it is an open meeting. I'm hoping there will be a lot of people participating beyond the committee.
Absolutely.
I mean, it's people that didn't apply for the committee. There's going to be, you know, liaisons from various boards and from the selectmen. Yeah, I think it's certainly a valid concern. You know, you want to get that input, but I think the types of things they'll wind up talking about will be significant enough that people will participate in the process.
Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Unanimous. Very good. Thank you again, gentlemen.
Thanks.
Well, this brings us to agenda item number 11. And that is the vote hawker peddler and ice cream vendor license renewals.
Here we are.
So, Ms. Trafton was here earlier. I don't see her now. We have Jenna Cakes, hawker peddlers. I think these are for to dine for. I think these are all for the farmers market.
Are
they, Kim? And they're renewals.
One ice cream vendor renewal that's been, Zach's Ice Cream has been with the town, I think, for 7 or 8 years.
So regarding the, I'm sorry.
So how, I have no problems voting on the farmer's market.
Like a motion for those?
How does the board feel?
I just want to make sure, is it truly restricted to the farmer's market as part of the motion, or?
Yeah.
I don't know how it works.
Yes,
it is.
Okay.
For the North Scituate Farmer's Market. Okay.
And I concur with the rest of the board. However, this is what I think we have to be careful of. You know, we have to be careful, I think, that we don't make a vote here tonight that's going to come back to bite us a month from now. And I just want to think this through for 1 second, because there are vendors at the farmer's market that are in competition with people in North Scituate. I would, without even thinking, without even knowing.
Sure.
So let's, do we want to just...
Agenda item 11.
The farmer's market just a completely separate...
General.
I think it is. It's a one-day-a-week thing for 4 hours.
Yeah, good, no problem. As long as we recognize, that's all I'm trying to do. I just don't want to say something tonight that'll...
Okay, but and I...
Yep, good.
Mr. Harris. And we do hear each one. These might be renewals here, but we do hear each one.
As they come in.
As they come in.
Yes.
Yep.
Not that we've said no to them, but...
I just want to point out, your own policy excludes jewelry.
Jewelry, yeah, I was just going to bring that up.
Yeah.
Why is that?
Although there is a, I believe, and having been to the market, there is a vendor there now that sells jewelry already.
This is a renewal, too. She sold it last year.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, our policy says...
But why
jewelry, furs, wines, or spiritus liquors, small artificial flowers, or miniature flags is prohibited.
Is that a state law about the flowers and the flags?
It sounds like it was taken from somewhere, I don't know.
It was taken from the state.
Spirits, I can understand. Yeah. Can't be selling spirits.
When is the farmer's market opening up?
Sean.
Is it May 15th?
Early June.
Can we wait just a little bit to think here?
Well, we want to change that.
We got to at least change that wording.
That has to be changed right away. I mean, that's
or know why it's on there. Yeah. Is there a state? Yeah. Why would the state
nothing?
Not?
Do we lose anything by tabling it for a couple of weeks?
And we've approved farmers market. The farmers market hasn't opened yet, has it, Kim? Do you know?
No, it hasn't. No, it has not. I think it's opening the first or second week in June, is my understanding. The only thing is that we've already taken care of a lot of renewals this year.
On the farmer's market.
It's more standing that Ms. Trafton doesn't only sell jewelry, she sells
Oh, no, that's correct. She sells other things. And this is, again, not her at all, per se. It's just the
it
whole issue.
Sticks and Stones Jewelry.
What
that's the name of that.
Sell, Kim?
She
it's
sells
not
other
listed.
Stuff, too.
Their applications, their renewal applications are there. Dinner cakes or cupcakes to dine for, or I think medicine foods.
That's right. And then that's the farmer who brings in all the
and
produce.
The farmer from Dyke Farm brings in all his fresh produce.
Right.
So.
Which is a draw to the right. Farmer's market.
Yes.
Yeah.
He's the only one.
The traditional.
He's the farmer.
He's the farmer. He's the farmer.
I guess, if I may, Mr. Chairman, I guess what we have to be careful about is setting a policy for not such, but I think we're all in agreement with the farmer's market. Setting a policy that would allow a vendor to be in competition with someone in North Scituate. I have no one in mind, but I'm sure there are competition there, with the drugstore, with Tedeschi's, or whatever.
Sure.
And then set a different policy, and say this to another vendor that comes in, nope, you can't be in competition, you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
And they would just turn around and say, well, last week you violated kind of violating your own policy.
What I could try to do is, because I did talk with some of the merchants in North Scituate
mm-hmm.
about 3 weeks ago.
Mm-hmm.
They like the farmer's market, the ones that were there.
Yeah.
Now, it wasn't everybody.
Yeah.
That's the downside.
Yeah.
But we can try to, or I can try to ascertain whether or not the general feeling of the merchants with the farmer's market for that one day. I know, because I'd asked whether or not they would consider changing it from Wednesday to a Saturday. And they said, no, it would probably go down because people leave the farmer's market and go to other farmer's markets, the vendors
but
themselves.
And I understand, and not so much the business is not Scituate being upset. I can see what's a plus for them. But I'm thinking of another vendor coming in.
Right, future ones who's going to say, I'm going to
sell. And say, you know, you're allowing competition.
Right.
See, I see the farmer's market as a completely separate animal, but... Mm-hmm. But if it doesn't matter, we might as well wait a couple of weeks, you know, if it's not even open.
Yeah.
If someone has a concern, I don't know.
I want to make sure that when we draw this thing up, we draw it up, unlike what it is now, where there's loopholes and exceptions, you know, we draw it up and make it pretty tight, that's all.
And I think we have to find out from the state if there's a law against selling jewelry in as a hawker vendor. I mean, I don't know why you would have put it in there if it wasn't.
I don't know.
Kim?
May I ask the town administrator a question through you?
Sure.
When you had your farmer's market in Western Mass, did everybody have hawker peddler's licenses? That's what, since
no, we got permission from the Board of Selectmen to use town property. And there is some sort of permitting process for some farmer's markets, but I don't know, or I don't, that it's through the, it's not a hawker's peddler's process.
That's what I'm thinking. Since this was a new idea in Scituate, we tried to put it under the hawker peddler, but I'm thinking that it's not appropriate.
So maybe there's another avenue.
Well, that's part of the reason. I mean, we had so many questions just around all the licensing in general, other than Kim's goal this year of reviewing the licenses and fees, the second step of that was looking at existing policies and updating them, which is why hawkers and peddlers, and I think entertainment licenses are on there. It was a natural progression in there. So, and this is another thing in terms of, you know, the farmer's market as far as giving permission for town property. But I think what this board originally discussed is what is an appropriate product for the farmer's market.
Right.
And again, we gave preference just to the town residents unless there was a void in the market, like produce. And therefore, I mean, all your renewals except for one are from nobody that lives in town.
Right.
But then again, you get back to the value-added discussion. Is it something that, you know, brings value to the market that somebody in town is not producing? And then there's also the other issue, like what you proved tonight for Roman's Table, is
right.
that somebody with a storefront already.
I was wondering that.
And then also doing,
definitely.
Which is supposed to be a handcrafted, self-employed home occupation in some ways for the farmer's market. So I think those are all issues as well. But they're going to be starting a lot sooner than school gets out. So again, you're sort of faced with another dilemma.
Well, I think we could probably wait a couple weeks at least to get, just to at least think this over a little more amongst ourselves, and just, because I did have the issue that she just mentioned about the store having the farmer's market as an outlet, and it would just, I mean, and Ms. Trafton's been so good with this whole, putting this whole thing together, but the jewelry and the policy and so on, I just kind of, just even a little more information would probably help. As Tony just said, is there some state rule about jewelry? Are we in inadvertent violation of? I mean, why is jewelry in our policy? Jewelry, furs, wines, spirits, liquors, artificial flowers, and miniature flags. That's clearly some sort of weird thing that comes from something else. Yeah.
John?
And to me, I kind of agree with what Kim's saying. I think these individuals that are going to the farmer's market don't even really fall under a hawker's peddler.
They might not. If there's, I would love it if there's a whole other avenue.
Does Cohasset, does Marshall, does Hingham all require them to go through the steps that we go through? I mean,
because if it's some other avenue is the better mechanism to use, then that solves Joe's problem as well. Then we're not dealing with, you know, the people with ice cream on wheels setting up shop outside another ice cream store with four walls. If it's some other whole avenue, then that could be, and that might be something, and that might be something that could be. Solved in a couple weeks.
Did you have to, that begs the question then, for all the people we have mandated, you know, hawker peddler's license.
It'll be a transition year.
And the fees.
I think it will be. I mean, generally the coordinator vets all the applications. They still fill out an application. We're dealing this week with insurance and things like that. But again, we're not the first community that has a farmer's market, and that's one on Saturday, one in Cohasset on Thursday, I think. So we can gather that information.
So let's put this then again, all these applications, Kim, for June 7th.
I was wondering if you could, these renewals or whatever they're going to be, could be put on for
May?
Well,
2 weeks?
I guess not next week, May 17th.
It really I guess
fine with me. I have no.
As far as the farmer's market is concerned, because I have a feeling maybe if it's possible, you may be considering going towards a farmer's market permit, a farmer's market license, something like
for
that.
For a renewal, right.
For
we
renewal.
Need a couple of weeks for that.
Right.
Yeah.
And then it can be more, it can be also addressed next fall in a bigger way.
And we can have them all renew at the same time.
Right.
I mean, that's the other thing is you could be much better than sort of the piecemeal doing as they come in, and we can set dates certain.
If there's a farmer's marker license
by the 17th. So I mean, I.
Yes.
Okay. That's great. If you can, then great. Let's put it on the 17th then.
Okay. Thank you.
All right.
So that dealt with the farmer's market. What about the ice cream truck, gentlemen?
I think that's
Ahmad Al-Khattabi.
He's kind of like the other problem we were dealing with.
Straight back to the other problem, which means June 7th.
I think all right. That's June 7th.
So he's June 7th.
June 7th discussion.
Do we need any motion to delay on these, or do we just table them?
No, just table it, I think.
Excellent.
Which brings us to agenda item number 12, a title which is the Proclamation of Arbor Day. Brings us to our clerk.
Yeah, quick drink. This is the Arbor Day proclamation. Whereas in 1872, J. Sterling Morton proposed to the Nebraska Board of Agriculture that a special day be set aside for the planting of trees, and whereas this holiday, called Arbor Day, was first observed in the planting of more than a million trees in Nebraska, and Arbor Day is now observed throughout the nation and the world, and whereas trees reduce the erosion of our precious topsoil by wind and water, cutting heat and cooling costs, moderate temperature, clean the air, produce oxygen, and provide habitat for wildlife, and whereas trees are a renewable resource giving us paper, wood for our homes, fuel for our fires, and countless other wood products, and whereas trees in our town increase property values, enhance the economic vitality of business areas, and beautify our community, and whereas trees, wherever they are planted, are a source of joy and spiritual renewal, and whereas the town of Scituate has been recognized as a Tree City USA by the National Arbor Day Foundation and desires to continue its tree planting practices, now therefore we, the Board of Selectmen of Town of Scituate, do hereby proclaim April 29th, 2011, Arbor Day, and urge all citizens to celebrate Arbor Day and to support efforts to protect our trees and woodlands. And further, we urge all citizens to plant trees to gladden the heart and promote the well-being this and for this and future generations.
Thank you. Moving on to agenda item number 13. It's a report from the town administrator. Tricia.
You have attached the financial trend monitoring report for the period ending March 31st. The paragraph I have there is that on the revenue side, we're doing well as compared with FY10, other than the significant decrease in state aid, which is shown there. And on the expense side, fire, overtime, FICA, and unemployment are running higher. The note there that at some point, you know, I'd like to meet with the chief and you to go over the staffing recommendations and report you received. Sometimes it doesn't seem to be enough time today to get some, but that's that. I'm happy to answer any questions. We're nearing the end of the fiscal year. By law, I can do interdepartmental transfers on the town side in May and June. I will be doing them the end of May, and then the advisory committee has to meet to approve them. So I sent out an email about, you know, basically the scrutiny of in departmental expenditures to June 30th, which if sometimes seems to, folks know they have money at year end and they are learning that that's no longer the case. Because we do have some account shortfalls in other accounts that I need to transfer those funds. And with, again, advisory committee support. And then we received two grants in the past 2 weeks that I'm very proud of and want to particularly commend Laura Harbottle, who not only brings them to my attention, but helps me shepherd them through the process with support letters and awarded them. The first is from the Metropolitan Area Planning Council on sea level rise. There is one error there where I say it's for the initial phase of the project. The funding we actually received is for the third phase of the project. The first phase is inundation study. The second is a vulnerability study. Rick, you can tell me how I'm doing. The third one is the one that's funded is for mitigation. So the three towns in conjunction together will have to come up with the cost estimates for phase one and phase two. We need to look at how we'll fund it, and then we get funding for third phase. Although any money that we don't have to fund is always welcome if we can work within the parameters. So I met with Jim O'Connell, our new conservation officer, this morning, who it's being coordinated by the town planner in Marshfield. So the mechanics of how it will work still hasn't really happened yet.
Can you please keep me in the loop on all that?
Yeah, absolutely. And as you can see, I'm still learning myself.
Yeah, it's all right. Yeah.
And the second one, which is even more complicated, and what I wrote is accurate, I can't say I understand it, is for the Solarize, Mass Solarize grant that we got to aggregate communities and businesses for incentives for generating kilowatt and solar efficiencies. This is a state program. As you know, and we're very, very proud of, only four communities in the state were selected. You had to be a green community to even be eligible. I think this is in keeping, as I know here, with the town's goal that we're doing very well at, is becoming a leader in green energy. And the town will have to get the word out to residents and businesses to be one of 50 initial projects in working with the state. They wanted to meet with us today. I pushed that meeting off because I hadn't been able to inform the board of the grant award. So Laura will take that meeting, I believe, next week to get the additional information and requirements out, because they're on a fast track as well. And Steve, I know you know, did I cover everything pretty well? Okay, so again, we just got notified, so we're getting up to speed. So good news, we've been really successful getting grants. And we apply, there's a lot we apply for that we don't get. But
can I make sure the Scituate Mariner makes note of that? Just sometimes people don't understand that we get a lot of, we get grants, so the town works
hard
to get
them. But we have to staff them. We have to carve that work out. And I actually had this conversation with Laura early in the week, because, this, you know, some of this work is in a support function, and Laura has her primary job as the planner. So that's something I think as we become more, first of all, we're actively seeking them and supporting them. But as we continue to receive them,
right,
there's an administrative responsibility for some of those that we look at, and particularly with planning doing the elevation, hazard elevation grants, and her and conservation doing the community rating system. There's a lot of things coming out of that office that aren't, you know, planning, but I think I have to be cognizant of looking long term. So, and then the last piece is, we will be rolling out the merit-based performance evaluations for the professional staff this year. That's a large, large task for 22 staff who will be evaluated based on the achievement of their FY11 goals, and will get any required merit-based based on the achievement of those goals relative to the other 22 people.
And this is the first time the town has done it?
This is the first time. It rolls out June 30th. New job descriptions need to be written for all of those positions that we're in the process of doing right now. And then the goals will be evaluated and evaluation will be written. It's about a 9-page document, and then we'll go forward from there. So that was one of the union bargained management proposals that we were able to obtain. And if people are interested watching of what those goals and objectives are, the town budget is on the website, and they can go to every department and see what those goals are. So, and I'm happy to answer any other questions.
Board? Thank you.
Thank
that's,
you.
That's a great thing that people should know about. You know. So, moving on to the next agenda item, 14, other business. Anyone? Bueller? I'm Ms. Murray?
Bueller. actually, just a return perhaps to agenda item 3, but not formally necessarily. Earlier tonight, we did vote on some hawker peddler's license for the farmer's market. And it was before we had the longer discussion. I think it was before you were here, Mr. Dempsey. And I don't know if that's now a done deal, or if we, but it just was brought to my attention as I was looking through this here. I feel very comfortable with what we've been doing with the latter ones, and I don't know if we're allowed to revisit or how we could discuss this at all, or what.
Good. I don't know. I don't know. First of all, I guess, is there a need to revisit it until we make a final determination? If a final determination affects these licenses in some way, then we might have to revisit the ones we voted. I don't think it will. I think,
well, if we're going to hold the last three, we got to kind of hold the
all
first two.
Yeah.
Did you guys vote to approve their license?
Yes,
we did. Yeah. So there's
one. They're both for the farmer's market.
That's correct.
Correct.
The diaper and the oil.
Well, in fairness to the early discussion about Amarok, you voted to approve that license and approved it and decided to take no further action for a number of reasons. So that I'm just throwing that out.
No, yeah, and I'm just thinking out loud, and it's just,
right,
you know,
I don't know if there's a right answer.
I'd let it go and just, your alternative is to rescind them.
Right, which.
And I don't think, if you want.
Well,
Well, we're still in the same meeting. Can't we just bring the question back?
Well, you'd have to bring it back up.
It can.
Yeah.
It hasn't been.
One of us could bring it back up, and you'd have to vote to.
Vote to bring it back up, and then.
Would have to be one of us that voted yes, which we all did. So, my sense is, they're not here.
That's right.
They're not here. I feel it would be a little, you know, they'd hear about it in the morning, and gee, that would be kind of awkward. But Joe, you might be right. I'm just thinking this through out loud. Maybe, let's say, and I'm not being prescriptive at all, but let's say we do come up with a new license for the farmer's market, the farmer's market permit or farmer's market license. You know, we could talk to those people and say, hey, can we put you on that instead of the hawker peddlers? And
we can revote it at any time. We can revote it 2 weeks from now. Doesn't have to be tonight.
Is that true procedurally? I just don't. No. Okay.
Well,
then you'd have to rescind it, right? Now we're just revoting. We haven't actually.
But
given
notice
it
would be given to the.
Notice would be given. I'm very comfortable with that. As long as we can do that. And again, I'm not trying to throw whatever in the ointment or whatever, but you know, it just occurred to me. So I'm fine. If we can revisit this later and if we're going to come up with a hawker's peddler's idea, perhaps, then I think we're still within the discussion period. Okay, that's it for me.
What would you gentlemen like to do on that?
I think it might be a moot point. Let's see what happens with the discussions down the road. And I have a feeling we just might tweak it a little bit. And the people that are interested in renewing their license for farmer's market, if I was a betting person, they will be there again this year. So rather than upset the people, if they're probably watching us on TV, I'm sure.
Sure. No, I agree. Since they're not here, and we could ask them. We say, hey, you know, this is what the path we prefer. There's this new thing. We do it this way and take it from there.
Doesn't it seem? Why don't we do it for these three? Is it just because of their renewals?
No, it's just because they're not here, and we already voted it. They were here earlier tonight. And
yeah, but if we don't agree with it.
I just think we have to be consistent.
I mean, I don't care if they're here or not here. They're going to hear about it, and they should understand if they watch the meeting what our concern is. I just think it looks a little silly if we voted the first two just because they were on the first page instead of the fifth page that they got their license.
I can't make a motion on reconsidering because I wasn't here for it. But I do hear what you're saying, and the consistency, if we granted it to the initial people and then further down, the other ones didn't get it. It does give the appearance of being inconsistent.
Can I make a suggestion? We go back and we vote the three that we held off on. There's your consistency. except our policy says jewelry, but I feel like Kim had mentioned earlier that it's not even a hawker's peddler's license. It's in the farmer's market and it's different.
Well, but we did call it a hawker's peddler license. The motion says it's a hawker's peddler, so
we have all along. But
yeah, no, I'm,
you know,
I'll make a motion to reconsider. What number was it? Two,
three.
Agenda item 3.
Agenda item 3.
Discussion vote: hawker peddler's license, North Scituate Farmers Market, Tracy Shepherd, the Roman Table. Motion by Mr. Vignani.
I'll second the motion for discussion.
Second by Mr. Murray. Further discussion.
Okay, so now there can be five people in the discussion because the motion has been made. So
I don't think you can vote on it, though.
You guys have to vote to
make a different motion.
We have to vote to bring it back up again.
So there's been a motion and a second, but we haven't voted to bring it up yet. Oh, okay.
All right. Now the vote will be taken to bring it back up.
Okay.
So all those in favor of bringing it back up.
All in favor of bringing it back up, say aye.
Aye.
All against?
Aye.
It's 3-1. I'm not voting on it, Kim, because I wasn't involved.
It's brought up for discussion.
Yeah, that's right.
That's okay.
Yeah.
So,
I was a little ahead there.
The question is, do we rescind at this point the two licenses issued earlier in the evening for the sake of consistency, because the subsequent licenses were not granted because we want to revisit this issue. And the question is, are we being inconsistent by granting it initially but not granting it to the other applicants? Maybe one position is, well, we granted it to them earlier on, Now we've come up with, we've identified the policy flaw, maybe some issues we want to further address. Since they've already got their license, we don't need to address it. Or we address it, and that way we need to rescind their license right now. Mr. Norton.
Kim, up to before tonight, we have voted farmers market licenses.
Yes.
So there's already farmers market licenses
mm-hmm.
on the books now. So if we want to be consistent, we have to go back and get all those we voted.
Well, those would have to be rescinded. These we haven't given out yet. Well, we haven't signed anything and given them a piece of paper.
Well, we voted them, so it's one step away from that. But to keep it, we still have licenses out there now for farmers market.
For this coming summer.
Yes.
4, 5, or 7, or 10, whatever it is.
Yep.
Yes.
So I'm thinking, let these go. We've already got a certain number out there. Address them all when we address the farmers market problem.
Mr. Vignani?
My only comment there is if you're going to let those go, then why?
Then Sean's.
We've got to do the other three also.
Yeah, I think you're right.
Do them too. I mean.
What was it? What's our concern with this?
Our concern with the other three?
With all of them.
Oh.
I think
there should be a whole nother licensing for farmers market.
It may not. A Hawker Peddler's license may not apply, and that it may be one permit. Satisfies all, I think, is what Tricia may have been indicating. Mm-hmm. At least it's an issue we got to look into.
And Joe's earlier point about are we treating the farmers market people separately from the people with the wheeled carts?
Yes.
Because the farmers market.
Obviously, yes. I mean.
Right. And so that was what actually Joe's comment there appropriately, I think, is what stimulated the idea. How can we mechanically treat the farmers market separately?
Then Tony raised the issue saying it's a one-shot, one deal a week
one
as
day,
opposed
yeah, correct.
To a Hawker's Peddler
right.
Do it
right.
Any time during the time.
I guess what I'm thinking here, with all the issues that are being raised, and they're all legitimate, they're all good, doesn't that make it more important to just get something permanent in place, something certain in place without doing something now that we may want to rescind when the Tricia and Kim come up with a policy.
So which way are you leaning, Joel?
I'm leaning probably to let the ones that we've already issued out there, leave them out there.
And what about these five?
Including the three where the
two
we voted
tonight.
Earlier. Yeah, we haven't.
Fine.
I mean, that's.
I'd probably say add the additional three. Give it to them. Let's go from there. Once we have a change in the policy, then it applies across the board without singling out three initially.
So the only question that I have there is the jewelry issue. She sold it last year. There's someone else selling jewelry. It seems kind of silly that you wouldn't be able to. Do we want to just... That would be a... If
and
there was
revisit.
A state reason, if we had to rescind it because it's a state law and you couldn't do it, then
it
you could do that.
Right. Would,
so we have to say we'd have to give a waiver for the 15-minute rule and the jewelry rule.
What else was on that thing other than jewelry?
Artificial flowers.
Furs, wines, spirits, small artificial flowers, or miniature flags. Keep in mind, not large artificial flowers, but small artificial flowers.
Or medium-sized flags.
I mean, I suppose what we could do, we can't, if it turns out that the state says you don't have the authority or the jurisdiction to be able to issue it, then whether we grant her a Hawker Peddler's license, it's void, period. If we find out that, and we'd have to tell her you can't sell it because we don't have the authority to grant it to you.
I mean, understand.
And she'd know that because she can't. She'd be in violation of state law.
So therefore, then, if I'm...
I believe she does sell other items, and I don't think it's all made jewelry. I think she sells stones separately. Whatever reason, you know, to make their own jewelry, whatever, but I don't think it's specifically all jewelry. I think she just was brief in her application.
Because
she had it last year, so
I'm inclined to say vote them in and then we'll address the issue.
Okay, so therefore then the number three will stand. All we voted was to discuss. We didn't vote to rescind or anything, so we don't have to do anything for number three because those things.
So moving on to agenda item number three. Any further discussion on agenda item number three?
No.
All right.
So then we need
another.
How about number 11 then? Agenda item 11. We never made any motion. We just let it sit. And this was for Angela Trafton, Jenna Perrette,
to dine for and Edward Sylvia, which were the renewals. Are we procedurally allowed to return back to an agenda item?
You got to move to, make a motion.
Got to make a motion. Okay, I would move to revisit agenda item number 11.
Second.
Seconded by Mr. Harris. Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Unanimous.
Would you like a motion, or do you have it in front of you, Rick?
I would move that the Board of Selectmen vote to renew Hawker Peddler's licenses for Angela Trafton, Jenna Perrette, to dine for, and Edward Sylvia for the North Scituate Farmers Market for 2011.
Second.
No.
Jenna's Cakes, you got that one?
No, that's
I did.
Okay. Seconded by Mr.
Second.
Mr. Harris. One, two.
That's four.
The only one that wasn't in there was the cupcakes. Jenna's Cakes.
No, it did. That's Jenna Perrette.
Jenna Perrette. Oh, two dine for. Fair enough.
Yep.
Dine for is a separate one. Further discussion? Seeing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Unanimous. Okay, in a roundabout way, that's been approved.
And we left out the ice cream guy because that's the wheeled situation.
Correct.
Mm-hmm. All right.
Thanks for bringing that up, Rick.
All right. Now, other business. Mr. Vignano?
No, I'm done, believe me.
I think you are.
He skipped you.
Just one quick comment. I was very impressed at the turnout at the annual town meeting. That was the largest crowd that I've seen, that I've ever seen in the 10 years I've been doing this. So I think there was 852 people, so a really good turnout. Obviously, that's just the first step in the process for those interested in the override, either for or against. The ballot is going to determine it. So on May 7th is the election day, and you have to go and vote for it, and that will determine whether it passes or doesn't. So May 7th is the day of note.
Time?
Time is...
Seven.
No.
8 to 5.
8 to 5.
Ms. Burbine.
Would it be possible to put on the recreation sign at the transfer station and on the sign into the high school, vote May 7th, 8 to 5, rather than the little signs that pop up around town that you're flying by and you really can't read? Would you consider something like that? Town election.
Sure.
May 7th.
Sure, I am.
Town election, 8 to 5, May 7th.
Reminder. That's yeah. Great.
That's a great idea. See what we can do.
Sounds great.
Mr. Harris?
Just a few things. I'll try to be as quick as I can. I'd just like to announce once again about the public forum for Pier 44. It is going to be Saturday, April 30th, at the Scituate High School Auditorium from 1 in the afternoon to 4 in the afternoon. And the public is really encouraged to attend. Okay, that's the Saturday. Secondly, if I could... there's a proclamation, it's new to me, on May is Older Americans Month, and if you'd just give me a couple minutes, I could read a
sure.
Whereas Scituate is a community that includes citizens age 60 and older, and whereas the older adults in Scituate are the roots from which our community grows, who bestow gifts of wisdom and insight upon younger generations and strengthen the bonds between neighbors to create a better place to live. And whereas our society can be enhanced by older adults aging peacefully in their communities, and whereas the older adults in Scituate should be commended in their role in creating and bolstering the fiber of our community and nation, and whereas our community can provide that recognition and respect by enriching the quality of life for older Americans by increasing their opportunities to remain in their communities as active and engaged citizens. Providing services, technologies, and support systems that allow seniors to foster and maintain connections within the community. Emphasizing the value of elders by publicly recognizing their contributions to the diversity, strength, and unity of our community. Now, therefore, we of Scituate, Massachusetts, do hereby proclaim that May 2011 to be Older Americans Month. We urge every citizen to take time this month to honor our older adults and their professionals, family members, and volunteers who care for them. Our recognition of older Americans and their involvement in our lives can help us achieve stronger and more meaningful connections with each other and enrich our community's quality of life. Signed by the entire board, John, myself, Rick, Joe, and Tony.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Joe?
Hope you all paid attention to that.
I think that's a new clerk in the making, isn't it?
The respect you're supposed to give older Americans. Couple of things that I'll make this as quick as possible. Sean brought up the fact that the Easter egg hunt was held at Widow's Walk by the Recreation Department on Saturday. And it wasn't the best of days by any means, but I understand they had a great turnout up there. So again, congratulations to them. Next Saturday is Ship Shape Day. Beautification does such a great job on that, and just wanted to acknowledge that anyone that could help out on that day would be appreciated. Thirdly, the town reports out is dedicated to a former selectman, Dick Blake, who we all know as principal of the Gates and a former selectman, and the book is dedicated to him, so that's all around town. And the last thing is the boat ramp. I had some questions, and I checked out with Mark Patterson on them, about the availability of the boat ramp for the boats to be put in the water, because it looks like now it's far from being completed. However, Mark spoke to the contractor, and the contractor said that the cement would be poured at the low tide, I think, which is around the 18th or 19th of the month. Let it set for a day or two, and shortly thereafter, boats will be able to use it. So it's probably delayed a week and a half longer than we would like it to be, thinking that we wanted the boats in by people who wanted to put them in by the 15th. But the end result is going to be so good and better than it was in the past, so it's probably worth that week and a half of unpleasant aggravation. Sure. So.
And when this was originally scheduled last year, the end date was going to be July 1.
Was it? Well,
so this is overall doing quite well.
And that's all I have, Mr. Chairman.
Sure. No, I was going to also touch on it again, Ship Shape Day. If you need to pick up any bags or gloves or items, come to the town hall from 8 in the morning until 1 in the afternoon. If you get involved, just try to go out and clean up some of your town, some of your neighborhood. If there's sections, whether it's the beaches or just in some of the parks, even some of the ball fields, just try to pick up some stuff, put them in a bag, and the town's going to go around and collect it. It's a great opportunity. I'm hoping it's going to be a great day. So get out there and, take pride in your town. The other thing I was going to say is, certainly with baseball, I was at the baseball, as I said earlier, somebody was driving by, they were on their cell phone, they were kind of going fast. And my point is that, people, if you're watching this, again, when you're around the ball fields, try to go slower. A lot of kids out there, boys and girls, they dart out in between cars. They're running around and frolicking, having a fun time. But again, if you're around the various ball fields, try to, again, keep in mind that try to go slow just for that situation. And the last thing I was going to raise is I happen to see it on our town logo, our town letterhead, is that the logo for the 375th is being utilized. And I don't know whose idea, but it's a great idea. And Tricia, that's a phenomenal, it's an awesome idea. I think it's great. And so if you get anything from the town.
The office door, too.
And I see it on the office doors, which is phenomenal. So. It has the 375th logo, so glad to see that the town's getting involved in the town hall. And I appreciate all the hard work that you've been doing, Kim, you in particular, and everyone else. So thank you. That's it for me on the other business. Therefore, I'll move over to the minutes on agenda item number 15.
Move the Board of Selectmen vote to accept the minutes of February 23rd, 2010, and just April 11th.
I just do period.
Period.
I could go in.
Second.
Is that seconded?
Yeah.
All in favor?
Aye.
And okay. I'm going to abstain on that one because I wasn't present. Now, move the Board of Selectmen vote to accept the minutes of April 11th, 2011.
Second.
Seconded by Mr. Murray. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
And lastly, move that the Board of Selectmen vote to accept the minutes of March 2nd, 2010.
Second.
Seconded by Mr. Murray. Discussion? Seeing none, all in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Great. That's going to bring us to the next agenda item. However, I did want to, under other business, want to recognize an individual, Mr. and Mrs. Eric Penahope, a letter from the Recreation Commission on behalf of the Friends of Scituate Recreation. The Scituate Recreation Commission wanted to, and the Recreation Department and its participants concerning the sailing program. Wanted to thank the Penahotes for their contribution of $5,000 to the Friends of Scituate Recreation, Inc., for the Scituate Recreation Department sailing program. Again, I repeat to the Penahotes, thank you very much, Scituate residents who donated $5,000 to the sailing program. We were truly moved by your generosity, as we all are. As you may know, all our programs are paid for and supported by user fees and donations. Your donation is going to have a tremendous positive impact, not only on the sailing program, but also all the children and the kids who participate. Our mission is to support, and this is the Scituate Recreation Department, our mission is to support the exceptional and creative program services and facilities that foster community spirit and involvement while enhancing the quality of life for all people in Scituate. We certainly will be able to continue our mission for the sailing program with the support of your benevolent donation. With sincere gratitude, E. Stephen Chase, the president of the Scituate Commission, Friends of Scituate Recreation, Inc. And again, this board and the town is very thankful for that donation. The town's always thankful for any donation amount for various programs and whatever amount that people can contribute. But in this case, we wanted to thank the Penahotes, so thank you very much. Moving on to the next agenda item, it's labor negotiations, non-union and union pending litigation. For reasons that we cannot, we have to go into discussions. If the open meeting is going to be closed, because if we discussed it in open session, everybody know what we're going to be doing in our plans. So accordingly, we need to have a roll call vote.
Mr. Marty?
Yes.
Mr. Vignani?
Yes.
Mr. Denny?
Yes.
Mr. Norton?
Yes.
Mr. Harris?
Yes.
Folks, good night. Have a good week.